Hey guys, did you know that a lot of you who watch my videos aren't subscribed yet? I'd really appreciate it if you could hit that subscribe button. And don't forget to like the video and leave a comment below. Your interaction really helps the channel grow and allows more people to see my content. Thanks so much for your support. I've lived in Alaska my whole life, in one of the busier parts of the state. I've seen a lot of strange things, even though I'm not that old. You name it, I've probably seen it. Sasquatch, otter people, dogmen, giant serpents, wendigos, even skinwalkers. And I've been unlucky enough to be hunted by two of them. It started one night at my friend's house. We were hanging out on the edge of their property, near a trail and a light pole. It was around 11 p.m., but with the Alaskan winter, it was already pitch black. We were chatting under the yellow light when I heard a branch snap and the crunch of snow. I figured it was a moose, so I told my friend to keep an eye out. Then it happened again, the sound of crunching snow, closer this time. My heart froze. I'm a pretty paranoid person, but this was before my paranoia had really taken hold. I felt it then, a wave of fear, like something was trying to control me. It must have been infrasound, the thing big cats use to paralyze their prey. I grabbed my friend and we ran. We didn't stop until we were inside, and I didn't sleep a wink that night. I was too scared of what was waiting outside. A few months later, in July, I was home alone, writing on my computer with the window open. I felt that strange sensation again, the feeling of being watched. I tried to ignore it, but it was overwhelming. I looked out the window, and there it was. A pale gray creature, skinny and disgusting, with sunken eyes and slightly protruding teeth. It was on all fours, but it had a human-like body, with long, twisted limbs. It saw me and started moving towards the house. I froze, then scrambled to close the window. The creature kept coming, its long, broken-looking legs carrying it closer. I finally got the window shut, locked it, and pulled the curtain down. That night, I hid in the bathtub, clutching a pocket knife and a blanket, terrified. I saw the creature a few more times that year, always around my house. It crawled at me from the driveway, scratched at my bedroom window, even tried to get into my parents' room one night. My cat, Fergus, used to warn me about it, hissing and spitting into the darkness. But Fergus passed away recently, and now I'm even more nervous. One week, things got really bad. I was in the living room when I heard something on the porch. I crept around the house, locking all the doors and windows. My dog started snarling, which he never does. I called my mom, crying, and she came home to find scratch marks on the wall outside her bedroom. Another time, I was in the living room again when I heard something in the carport. I panicked, ran to the bathroom, and locked myself inside. I heard it moving around the backyard, trying to get in. I was terrified. The last time I saw it was the worst. I was on a Discord call with my friends, hanging out in the kitchen. I felt that familiar feeling of being watched, and I looked down at the back door. There it was, staring at me through the window, its sunken eyes and gray skin barely visible in the dim light. I ran to the bathroom again, but this time, it followed me, I heard it scratching at my bedroom window, then at my parents' room. It opened the door, sniffed around, and even stepped on the board covering the entrance to the crawl space where I was hiding. I was frozen with fear, but somehow, it didn't find me. That was the last time I saw the creature, but I know it's still out there. I'm never truly alone in my own home. The cryptids are real, and they're a lot more aggressive here in Alaska. The phone's shrill ring pierced the quiet morning. It was Mom, her voice uncharacteristically cheerful. This was strange. It had been just 3 days since Buster, her beloved beagle, had passed away. 3 days of near silence from Mom, punctuated only by muffled sobs. "Ethan, you have to come see this. Buster's back." My heart skipped a beat. "Back? How?" I pushed aside the confusion and rushed over to her house, a knot of worry tightening in my stomach. The scene that greeted me was beyond bizarre. There, in the living room, was a man easily 7 feet tall, clad in a black, full-body dog costume, complete with a creepy, expressionless mask. Mom was beaming, showering the dog with affection. "Isn't it wonderful?" He came back to me. My mind reeled. Was this some elaborate prank? A bizarre coping mechanism? Or had Mom completely lost it? "Mom," I began, my voice trembling, "who is that?" Her smile faltered. "It's Buster, Ethan. Can't you see?" I glanced at the masked man. His eyes, visible through the mask's eye holes, were fixated on me, cold and calculating. A shiver ran down my spine. Something was terribly wrong. Days turned into a blur of bewilderment and fear. The dog never left Mom's side, following her everywhere, even sleeping at the foot of her bed. He never spoke, only growled and whimpered. His presence was suffocating, a constant reminder of the absurdity of the situation. One evening, I found Mom sobbing, the dog nuzzling her. "He's not my Buster," she cried, "but he's all I have left." My heart ached for her. This thing had taken advantage of her grief, her loneliness. I had to do something. The next morning, I called the police, reporting a suspicious individual at my mother's house. They arrived, skeptical but cautious. The dog remained eerily calm, his masked face betraying no emotion. The officers questioned Mom, but she insisted it was Buster, her beloved pet. They exchanged uneasy glances. Clearly, they thought she was delusional. Just as they were about to leave, the dog lunged at one of the officers, growling and snapping. Chaos erupted. In the ensuing struggle, the mask was ripped off, revealing a face contorted with rage, eyes filled with a chilling, animalistic intensity. He fled, disappearing into the woods. The police gave chase, but he was gone. Vanished without a trace. Mom was devastated. The dog, her strange comfort, was gone. I brought her to my apartment, determined to help her heal. It's been months since the incident. Mom is slowly recovering, though the memory of the dog still haunts her. And me? I can't shake the feeling that something sinister was at play, something beyond our understanding. The incident has left an indelible mark, a chilling reminder of the darkness that can lurk beneath the surface of the ordinary. The biting wind howled like a hungry wolf, tearing through the snow-covered pines of northern Ontario. Joe and I were heading home after a successful weekend of ice fishing, our SUV laden with walleye and bass. But the worst blizzard in decades had other plans for us. A road closure forced us onto a narrow, snow-choked trail, the setting sun casting long, eerie shadows. The further we ventured, the more uneasy I felt. This was prime wolf country, and darkness was closing in fast. Suddenly, a pair of glowing red eyes pierced the gloom. We slammed on the brakes, our hearts pounding. The creature emerged from the shadows, a hulking monstrosity that defied description. It was like a wolf, but stood on two legs, its eyes burning with malevolent intent. Dogman, Joe breathed, his voice filled with awe and terror. Before we could react, the beast lunged, its claws tearing at the SUV's door. It smashed through the windshield, snarling, its putrid breath filling the car. We were trapped, at the mercy of this nightmarish creature. Just as it lunged for my throat, a shot rang out. Then another. The dogman howled in pain, its blood splattering the interior of the SUV. A figure emerged from the darkness, rifle in hand, a grim determination etched on his face. He fired again, and the dogman retreated into the woods, leaving a trail of blood and carnage in its wake. Our savior, a man named Patrick, introduced himself as a dogman hunter. He had been tracking this creature for weeks, drawn by reports of mutilated animals and terrified locals. Patrick, a seasoned survivalist, helped us escape the wrecked SUV and took us to his cabin. We spent the night huddled around the fire, listening to his tales of encounters with these terrifying creatures. The next morning, we returned to the scene of the attack. The SUV was a mangled wreck, its contents ravaged. Patrick was grim. "This isn't over," he said. "It'll be back." We left the woods that day, forever changed by our encounter with the dogman. The experience had shaken us to our core, leaving us with a profound respect for the wild and its hidden dangers. But it had also sparked a fascination in Joe, who, with Patrick's guidance, began to delve deeper into the world of dogman hunters. As for me, I remained wary, content to leave the mysteries of the wilderness undisturbed. Some things, I realized, are best left unknown. The campfire crackled, casting long shadows that danced with the flames. A chill wind whipped through the pines, sending shivers down our spines. We huddled closer, seeking warmth and comfort in each other's presence. It was supposed to be a fun family camping trip, but now, an unsettling feeling crept into my gut. My wife Sarah, our daughter Lily, and I had always loved the outdoors. The whispering trees, the rustling leaves, the symphony of nature's orchestra. It was our escape, our sanctuary. But this time, something felt different. We'd set up camp in the heart of the Redwood National Park, eager to explore its majestic beauty. The first day was idyllic, hiking through towering trees, marveling at the ancient giants, and roasting marshmallows over the campfire. But as the sun dipped below the horizon, a sense of unease settled over us. It started with a rustling in the underbrush, a sound too heavy for a squirrel, too deliberate for a deer. Then, a twig snapped, closer this time, followed by the distinct sound of footsteps approaching our campsite. We exchanged nervous glances, our laughter dying in our throats. "Hello?" I called out, my voice echoing in the stillness. No response. The footsteps stopped, but the feeling of being watched intensified. We strained our ears, listening for any sign of the intruder, but the forest remained eerily silent. As the night wore on, the tension grew thicker. Every creak of a branch, every rustle of leaves, sent our hearts racing. We huddled closer to the fire, its flames our only source of comfort in the encroaching darkness. Then, a blood-curdling scream pierced the night. It was a sound of pure terror, a sound that sent shivers down our spines and made our blood run cold. We froze, our eyes wide with fear, our breaths caught in our throats. The scream was followed by an eerie silence, a silence that was more terrifying than any sound. We waited, our ears straining for any sign of life, but the forest remained silent, holding its breath. Finally, unable to bear the suspense any longer, I grabbed my flashlight and cautiously ventured into the darkness. The beam of light danced across the trees, illuminating the path ahead. My heart pounded in my chest, each step filled with trepidation. Then, I saw it. A figure, tall and shadowy, lurking in the distance. It was too large to be human, its shape distorted and grotesque. It stood motionless, its eyes glowing in the darkness, watching me. Fear gripped me, paralyzing me in its icy embrace. I stumbled back, my flashlight slipping from my grasp. The figure remained motionless, its eyes burning into me. I turned and ran, my heart pounding in my chest, the creature's eyes following me. I didn't stop running until I reached the safety of our campsite, where Sarah and Lily were huddled together, their faces pale with fear. We didn't waste a second. We threw our belongings into the car and sped away, leaving behind the campfire, the tent, and the terrifying memory of the creature in the woods. As we drove through the night, the image of the creature haunted me. Its eyes, glowing in the darkness, seemed to follow us, watching our every move. I couldn't shake the feeling that we were being hunted, that the creature was still out there, lurking in the shadows. We never went back to that campsite, and we never spoke of the creature again. But the memory of that night, the terror, the fear, the feeling of being watched, remained with us, a chilling reminder of the darkness that lurks just beyond the edge of our world. I grew up in a small town bordering a vast national forest. My friend Mike and I often explored its trails, always with a compass to avoid getting lost. The day after my 18th birthday, we set out on a hike, aiming for a remote campsite deep within the woods. We followed the red marked trail, the longest one, which promised a camping area according to the tent symbol on the sign. After about 4 hours, we stumbled upon an overgrown dirt road. Curiosity piqued, we decided to follow it, hoping it might lead to something interesting. The road was rough, but eventually, we saw a large wooden house through the trees. As we got closer, we saw handwritten signs warning us to keep out. The house looked abandoned, so we ignored the warnings. The door was chained and locked, but we found a piece of iron fencing and managed to break the lock. Inside, the house was coated in dust and grime. Boar and stag heads adorned the walls, illuminated by the faint light filtering through cracks in the boarded-up windows. The place looked like it hadn't been touched in decades. Mike went upstairs while I checked out the kitchen. The house creaked with every step he took. "Anything up there?" I shouted. "Nah," he replied. "Just looks like my grandparents' house, but dusty as hell." I laughed. "Same down here." Under the stairs, I found a door, stuck fast. "Mike, get down here," I yelled. Together, we forced the door open, revealing a staircase leading to a basement. The steps were rickety, but we made our way down, our flashlights cutting through the darkness. Large glass cases lined the walls, and a massive case stood in the center of the room. All were covered in a thick layer of dust. "Something died in here," Mike said, wrinkling his nose. "Yeah, this doesn't feel right," I agreed. Suddenly, Mike shouted, "Oh fuck, what the hell is that?" He'd wiped the dust off one of the cases, revealing a grotesque wax figure of a woman. I felt a chill run down my spine. "What is this place?" I whispered. We wiped off a few more cases, each containing more creepy wax figures. Then we saw what was in the central case. A human body, clothed and bound, its flesh withered and decayed. I nearly dropped my flashlight. "We need to get out of here," I said. As I reached for an envelope on a nearby table, we heard a loud tap from one of the cases behind us. We jumped, our hearts pounding. "Fuck this," Mike stammered. "Bring it with us." "Let's go." We ran out of the house as if the devil himself was on our heels. We didn't stop until we reached the trail, then hurried back to my car. Shaken and exhausted, we sat in the car, and I pulled out the envelope. Inside was a handwritten note. It was a confession from a self-proclaimed collector who had turned his taxidermy skills to preserving humans. He described his collection of over 43 bodies, all accidents that he had orchestrated. The note ended with him stating he was about to take his own life, leaving his gruesome collection for others to find. I felt sick to my stomach. We reported the note and the house to the police, but they never found any trace of it. They searched for weeks, but the forest had swallowed it whole. We never went back to that forest. We never even spoke about it again. But I still remember the house, those wax figures, and the chilling words of the collector. Sometimes, I wonder if anyone else has stumbled upon his horrifying collection. The winter of 97 hit Colorado hard. Snow piled high, burying the town of Aspen under a thick white blanket. I was with my friend, Mark, heading back from a weekend of ice fishing in the mountains. Our truck was packed with trout, and we were eager to get home, but the blizzard had other plans. As we descended Black Bear Pass, the narrow, winding road that snaked through the Rockies, we saw flashing lights ahead. Two police helicopters hovered over a section of the highway, bringing traffic to a standstill. A chill ran down my spine. this wasn't a good sign. We later learned that a couple had skidded off the icy road and plunged into the ravine. With the highway closed, we had no choice but to turn around and seek an alternate route. We found ourselves navigating a narrow, snow-covered track barely wide enough for our truck. The snowbanks on either side towered over us like frozen waves, threatening to engulf us. Mark, ever the optimist, assured me we'd be fine, but I couldn't shake the feeling of unease. The sun was setting, casting long shadows across the snow, and the temperature was dropping rapidly. Suddenly, Mark slammed on the brakes. "Did you see that?" he whispered, pointing towards the trees. I squinted, trying to make out what he was pointing at. A flicker of light danced among the trees, like a campfire. And then we heard it, a chilling howl that echoed through the forest. It sounded like a wolf, but deeper, more guttural. Before I could process what was happening, a pair of glowing red eyes emerged from the darkness. A large, canine-like creature stepped onto the road, its silhouette illuminated by the headlights. It stood on its hind legs, its body covered in dark fur. It was unlike anything I had ever seen. Mark grabbed his rifle from the back seat. "Get down," he yelled. The creature lunged at our truck, its claws raking across the hood. Mark fired a shot, and the creature yelped, retreating into the shadows. We were both shaken, our hearts pounding in our chests. Just when we thought the creature was gone, it reappeared, its eyes burning with rage. It smashed through the windshield, showering us with glass. Mark fired another shot, but the creature kept coming. I braced myself for the worst. Suddenly, another shot rang out, this one from behind us. The creature howled in pain and stumbled back. A figure emerged from the trees, a man with a rifle. He approached cautiously, his eyes scanning the darkness. "You folks all right?" he asked, his voice gruff. We nodded, still in shock. The man introduced himself as Jake, a hunter who had been tracking the creature for weeks. He explained that it was a Dogman, a legendary creature said to roam the remote areas of the Rockies. Jake helped us patch up our truck and escorted us back to the main road. We thanked him profusely for saving our lives. As we drove away, I couldn't help but look back at the dark forest, wondering if the Dogman was still out there, watching us. The encounter left a lasting impression on me. I had always been skeptical of stories about mythical creatures, but now I knew they were real. The Dogman was out there, a reminder that there are still mysteries in this world that we may never fully understand. The snow was falling hard that night in the Colorado Rockies, the kind of blizzard that makes you glad to be indoors. But I wasn't indoors. I was with my buddy, Mark, driving back from a fishing trip up near Leadville. Our truck was loaded down with trout, and we were both looking forward to a hot meal and a warm bed. But the storm had other plans for us. We were on Lost Creek Road, a narrow, winding track that cut through the mountains, when we came across a roadblock. Two police cars, their lights flashing, blocked the road. A couple of officers were directing traffic, their faces grim. We soon learned that a rock slide had made the road impassable. Mark, never one to back down from a challenge, decided to try an alternate route. I know a shortcut, he said, a mischievous glint in his eye. It'll take us a bit longer, but we'll get there. I wasn't so sure, but I trusted Mark. He'd grown up in these mountains, and he knew them like the back of his hand. So we turned off onto a dirt road, barely visible under the thick layer of snow. The road was narrow and treacherous, with steep drop-offs on either side. The snow was coming down harder now, and the wind was howling like a hungry wolf. I was starting to get nervous. Are you sure this is the right way? I asked, my voice barely a whisper. Relax, Mark said, his eyes fixed on the road ahead. We'll be fine. But I couldn't relax. The road was getting worse, and the darkness was closing in. Then, I saw it. A pair of glowing red eyes, watching us from the trees. Did you see that? I whispered, my heart pounding in my chest. Mark nodded. Yeah, I saw it. He reached for his rifle, which was lying on the seat between us. The creature stepped out of the shadows. It was tall and muscular, with a dog-like head and a human-like body. Its fur was dark, almost black, and its eyes glowed like embers. What is that thing? I asked, my voice trembling. I don't know, Mark said, his voice low and steady. But it doesn't look friendly. The creature let out a growl, a deep, guttural sound that sent shivers down my spine. Mark raised his rifle and fired a shot. The creature yelped and disappeared back into the trees. That should scare it off, Mark said. But it didn't. A few minutes later, the creature reappeared, this time closer. It was angry, and it was hungry. Mark fired another shot, but the creature kept coming. It lunged at our truck, its claws raking across the hood. I ducked down, covering my head with my arms. Suddenly, another shot rang out, this one from behind us. The creature howled in pain and fell to the ground. A figure emerged from the trees, a man with a rifle. He approached cautiously, his eyes scanning the darkness. You folks all right? He asked, his voice calm and reassuring. We nodded, still shaken. The man introduced himself as Jake, a local hunter who had been tracking the creature for weeks. He explained that it was a Dogman, a legendary creature said to roam the remote areas of the Rockies. Jake helped us get our truck back on the road, and we followed him to his cabin, where we spent the night. He told us stories about the Dogman, and we listened in awe. The next morning, we thanked Jake for his help and headed back to town. We were both shaken by our encounter with the Dogman, but we were also grateful to be alive. We knew that we had been lucky, and we would never forget the night we met the Dogman of Lost Creek Road. I grew up in a small village in the backwoods of Oregon. Our house was a simple wooden cabin, surrounded by towering pines and the ever-present smell of damp earth. I loved eating fruit, especially the wild berries that grew in the forest. But I wasn't the only one with a taste for them. To get the best pickings, I had to wake up before dawn, before the other kids in the village could beat me to it. One morning, with the sky still dark and the village asleep, I set out with my flashlight, a bag slung over my shoulder, and a small knife tucked into my belt. The forest was silent, except for the chirping of crickets and the occasional hoot of an owl. I knew these woods like the back of my hand, every trail, every stream. As I walked, I scanned the trees for ripe berries, my flashlight beam cutting through the darkness. Then I heard it. An owl, unlike anything I'd ever heard before. It was deep and guttural, sending shivers down my spine. I froze, my heart pounding in my chest. The owl echoed through the trees, closer now. Fear gripped me, and I started to run. I didn't know what was out there, but I knew I didn't want to find out. I could hear it behind me, crashing through the undergrowth, getting closer. My breath came in ragged gasps, and my legs burned. I glanced back, but I couldn't see anything in the darkness. Just when I thought I couldn't run any further, I saw a figure standing in the path ahead. It was my dad, his rifle raised. He must have heard the commotion and come to investigate. I didn't have time to explain. The creature was almost upon us. My dad fired a shot, and the creature yelped, the sound echoing through the trees. It crashed to the ground, then scrambled away, leaving a trail of blood in its wake. We stood there for a moment, listening to the creature's fading whimpers. Then, slowly, the forest fell silent again. We never did find out what it was, but I never forgot the terror of that night, the sound of that howl, and the feeling of being hunted. From that day on, I never went into the woods alone. I knew what I was getting into when I moved to rural Vermont. Everyone knows about the strange things that happen in these old New England towns, the stories whispered around campfires and passed down through generations. But hey, a good salary and a fresh start were worth a little risk, right? At least that's what I told my 7-year-old, Emily. Kids these days, with their tablets and internet access, sometimes I think it would have been easier raising her in the 1600s. No online predators to worry about back then, just the occasional witch hunt. Speaking of Emily, she wasn't thrilled about the move. We had a pretty sweet setup back in Connecticut, small town, good schools, everything within biking distance. But IT jobs were scarce, and when this opportunity in Vermont popped up, I couldn't say no. Emily hadn't taken the news well. 20 minutes after I told her, she stormed into the living room, demanding we stay put. But Emily, I tried to reason, Vermont has forests and mountains. We can go hiking and exploring. That didn't seem to impress her. She loved our little house in Connecticut, with its tiny backyard and the park down the street. But I finally managed to convince her with the promise of a magic protection potion, pink lemonade, ginger ale, and a dash of hot sauce, served in her fanciest teacups. It worked like a charm. Kids are so easy sometimes. We moved at the end of June, giving Emily the whole summer to adjust before starting school. Our new place was a cozy 2-bedroom cottage with a big backyard that bordered on a sprawling forest. Emily, who dreamed of becoming a soccer star, was thrilled with all the space to run around. I, on the other hand, was a little unnerved by the endless stretch of trees behind our house. But hey, a dad's gotta do what dad's gotta do. My new job at the local community college was a dream. Better pay, better benefits, and a surprisingly good daycare program, which was a lifesaver since we were hours away from any family or friends. For a few weeks, everything was perfect. Emily loved her new friends at daycare, and I was settling into my new routine. Maybe this move was a good idea after all. Then came that Thursday. A power outage forced the college to close early, and I found myself heading home at 3 p.m. with an unexpected afternoon off. Emily was ecstatic when I suggested we explore the woods behind our house. On the drive home, I watched her excitedly texting her friends, no doubt bragging about our impromptu adventure. The trail was quiet and shaded, the air thick with the scent of pine needles and damp earth. We walked for about an hour, Emily chattering away about her new friends and the games they played at daycare. I was enjoying the peace, the rare chance to just be present with my daughter, when a sudden wave of dread washed over me. I glanced at Emily, who was happily balancing on a fallen log, seemingly oblivious to the unease that had gripped me. I scanned our surroundings, but nothing seemed out of place. It had been a while since I'd had a panic attack, but my racing heart and the tightness in my chest were unmistakable signs. I took a deep breath, trying to calm myself. I said, trying to keep my voice steady, "Stay close, okay? Just for a little while." She nodded, her attention already back on the log. I kept walking, my eyes darting from side to side, searching for the source of my anxiety. But there was nothing there. Just trees and shadows. Suddenly, I realized Emily had stopped. She was standing a few feet off the trail, staring into the woods, her face pale and drawn. "Emily? What's wrong?" She didn't answer. I hurried over to her, kneeling down to meet her eyes. "Sweetheart, are you okay?" Her lips trembled. "Daddy," she whispered, using the childhood nickname she'd long abandoned, "I want to go home." My blood ran cold. Something was definitely wrong. I scooped her up, my heart pounding in my ears. "Emily, tell me if you see anything following us," I said, my voice a strained whisper. We hadn't gone far when she screamed, "Dad." I spun around, my eyes frantically searching the trees. And then I saw them. Two figures, no older than 10 or 11, standing silently in the middle of the path. They were dressed in plain clothes, their skin pale and unhealthy looking in the dim light. But it was their eyes that terrified me. They were completely black, like empty voids. "W, what do you want?" I stammered, my voice shaking. "We've lost our friend," they said in unison, their voices flat and emotionless. "Have you seen her?" "No," I managed to choke out. "We haven't seen anyone." "She can be our friend," they said, taking a step closer. I felt a surge of terror, a primal fear that seemed to rise from the depths of my soul. "No, she can't," I said, my voice barely above a whisper. I backed away slowly, never taking my eyes off them. They didn't follow, but they didn't move either. Just stood there, watching us with those empty eyes. Finally, I turned and ran, Emily clinging tightly to me. I didn't stop until we reached the house, slamming the door shut and locking it behind us. I called the police, my hands still shaking. I told them about the lost children, but I couldn't bring myself to mention their eyes. They promised to send someone out to patrol the area, but I knew it was pointless. Those weren't ordinary children. The rest of the day was a blur of anxiety and fear. I couldn't shake the feeling that we were being watched, that those black-eyed children were still out there, waiting for us. Night fell, and I found myself unable to sleep. I lay on the couch, listening to every creak and groan of the old house, my mind replaying the events of the day. Around 1 a.m., I heard it. A faint tapping sound coming from the window. I froze, my heart pounding in my chest. The tapping continued, slow and deliberate. I crept towards the window, peering through the blinds. There was nothing there. Just the empty streetlit street. I let out a shaky breath, telling myself it was just my imagination. But then I heard it again. This time it was coming from Emily's room. I rushed to her door, flinging it open. Emily was kneeling on her bed, her back to me, the window wide open. And standing outside, framed in the moonlight, was a tall, shadowy figure. I screamed and lunged for the window, but the figure was already gone. Emily burst into tears, and I pulled her close, my body trembling with fear and rage. Over the next few days, the pieces of the puzzle fell into place. Emily had made a new friend at the daycare, a man named Jay who claimed to be the college groundskeeper. He had been grooming her for weeks, gaining her trust with small gifts and friendly conversations. He had even been sending her messages on her phone, telling her how special she was, how much he cared for her. The police identified Jay as Thomas, a drifter with a history of predatory behavior. They raided his home, but he was gone. All they found were traces of other missing children, evidence of a horrifying pattern of abduction and abuse. I shuddered to think how close I had come to losing Emily. If it hadn't been for those black-eyed children warning us, she would have been another victim, another name on a missing person's poster. We left Vermont soon after, moving back to Connecticut to be closer to family. Emily's phone was confiscated, and she received a stern lecture about the dangers of online strangers. But the fear remained, a constant shadow lurking in the back of my mind. I knew that the world was a dangerous place, that monsters lurked in the shadows, waiting to snatch away the innocent. And I knew that I would never truly feel safe again. They call me a wilderness expert. Been exploring forests for nearly 2 decades now. I'm no fool. I plan my trips carefully. Always pack enough supplies to last a couple of weeks, just in case I get lost. Satellite phone, GPS, even a weapon as a last resort. Sometimes, getting lost is part of the thrill, you know? As long as you know what you're doing. But the story I'm about to tell you, this is about a guy who didn't take those precautions. A guy who wandered into the unknown and paid the price. It happened on my last trip to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. Deep in the woods, I found a journal hanging from a tree. Only a few pages left, the rest torn out. Kindling, the writer said. The contents? Strange. Disturbing. But I'll let you be the judge. My name is Alex Walker. Student at Western Carolina University. Don't know the exact date, but I started this on August 3rd, 2023. Been about 2 weeks now, I think. If you find this, stop looking for me. Not much paper left, so I'll keep it short. About a week before I came out here, I got a message on Facebook. Some guy said he was looking for adventurers, young and fit, to earn some cash. Offered me $1,000 to spend 48 hours in the woods, surviving on whatever I could find. Said he was writing a book about wilderness survival. Wanted to see how people would handle it. He provided a backpack with some supplies, a GoPro to record everything. I used to be an Eagle Scout, so I figured, why not? 2 days in the woods is nothing. And with that kind of money, I could upgrade my gaming rig and have enough left over for pizza for the rest of the semester. We set up a meeting. He told me to just bring some sturdy clothes, he'd provide the rest. When I met him, he seemed normal enough. Rich, though. He dropped me off in the forest in his private helicopter. On the flight over, he explained that the backpack had a GPS tracker so he could find me after the 48 hours. I trusted him. He seemed to know what he was doing. He dropped me off and flew away. I checked out the backpack. A simple pocket knife, which I put in my pocket. This journal, which I also pocketed. A matchbook with two matches, a water bottle, one of those thermal blankets, some rope, and other basic survival stuff. Oh, and the GoPro, which I strapped to my chest. No map, no compass, no navigation tools. The idea was to be lost and survive. So I set off. Spent the first day hiking in a straight line, trying to get my bearings. Nothing but thick trees. I wanted to find a water source, but no luck. It was getting dark, so I decided to set up camp. Gathered some branches and brush, found a small clearing. Used the pocket knife to cut some smaller branches for firewood. Had to use some pages from this journal to get the fire going with one of my matches. So far, so good. I wrapped myself in the thermal blanket and slept next to the fire. Woke up before sunrise. The fire was dead, and I didn't want to waste my other match, so I packed up and kept moving. After a few more hours, I heard it running water. A stream. My water bottle was almost empty, so I was thrilled. 2 days in the woods for $1,000. Easy money. I followed the stream, hoping to find a lake. I was getting hungry. A nice lake with some fish would be perfect. But even if I didn't find any food, I could last 2 days without eating. It got dark again, and the stream was getting wider, but still no lake. I should have stopped to make camp while there was still light, but I was determined to find that lake. Finally, it was too dark to see. There was some moonlight, but not enough. I gathered some wood in the dark and set up camp. Used more pages from the journal to start the fire with my last match. Then I crashed, hoping to find that lake in the morning. A loud cracking woke me up in the night. Branches snapping all around me. I jumped up, heart pounding. Bears. Wolves? I had to do something. I couldn't just stand there and be eaten. I decided to climb a tree, The fire was dying down, but I had enough light to see. I climbed up about 6 feet when the noises stopped. I listened, but all I could hear was my own heartbeat. I waited, gripping the branches. Silence. Maybe whatever it was had gone. I shifted my weight, and the branch I was standing on snapped. I lost my grip and fell, hitting my head on the ground. Everything went black. When I woke up, it was still dark, pitch black, and I wasn't on the ground. I was on something hard and flat, like a table. I tried to sit up, but I couldn't move. My hands and feet were tied down. Panic set in. I thrashed against the restraints, yelling, "What the fuck?" over and over. I heard voices all around me, but I couldn't understand what they were saying. Who was out here? Who would tie someone up in the middle of the woods? I kept struggling, and the ropes loosened a little. Then things got really weird. A loud thumping sound. Branches breaking. No, trees, whole trees snapping in half. Something was coming closer. The voices got louder, chanting. I realized I was some kind of sacrifice. It was so crazy, so unreal, I almost couldn't believe it was happening. The thumping and the chanting grew louder. I could see a shape against the moonlight. It was huge. Impossibly huge. I screamed and struggled against the ropes. The forest was being torn apart in front of me. The creature was maybe 100 yards away when I got one hand free. Tears and snot were running down my face. I wiped my eyes and quickly untied the other hand. The creature roared, and the chanting stopped. I fumbled with the ropes on my feet, and a few seconds later, I was free. I jumped up and ran, stumbling and falling. I was dizzy, disoriented. They must have drugged me. I kept running. I could hear the creature behind me, but I didn't look back. It was slow, or maybe it just didn't care. After a few minutes, I couldn't hear it anymore. But I didn't stop. I couldn't. Even if the creature wasn't following me, those chanting voices, they wouldn't let me get away that easily. Finally, the sun started to rise. I'd been running all night. I stopped, leaned against a tree, and slid to the ground. I was terrified, exhausted, and in pain. I put my head between my legs and sobbed. When I finally calmed down, I wiped my face and took stock. The backpack and the GoPro were gone. All I had was the pocket knife and this journal. And no way for that guy to find me. I had no idea where I was. The stream was gone. I was lost. Really lost. They say you should stay put if you get lost, but I couldn't. Not with that creature and those cultists out there. I had to keep moving. I had to get that backpack back. I walked for hours. Nothing looked familiar. The sun was high in the sky, but still no sign of a helicopter. I kept walking all day. When it got dark again, I was still lost. No supplies. Just the knife and the journal. I remembered how to start a fire with sticks. It took forever, but I finally got one going. Used more pages from the journal for kindling. I didn't sleep. Too risky. Just sat by the fire all night, trying to stay warm. Morning came, 3 days I've been out here. I was starving and thirsty. I had to find that stream again. I tried to remember which way I'd been walking, based on the sun. I thought I figured it out and started walking. All day. Nothing. So I made camp and actually managed to get some sleep. That's how many people have disappeared from Yosemite National Park this year. Vanished without a trace. And no one's talking about it. I'm probably going to lose my job for posting this, but honestly, I'm more scared of what's happening in the park than I am of getting fired. This needs to get out. I'm a wilderness ranger at Yosemite. My job is to hike the trails, keep an eye out for trouble, and help lost or injured hikers. It used to be that if someone got lost, we'd all go out and search until we found them. But things changed in 2022. Now, when someone goes missing, we tell their family we're on it, that we'll search high and low. But the minute they're out of sight, our bosses tell us to back off, that a private search and rescue team will take over. We're told to focus on trail maintenance and keep our mouths shut. At first, it was just a few people here and there. We thought it was strange that rangers weren't involved in the searches, but we figured it was some new policy and let it go. But as more people started disappearing, we all started to wonder what was going on. Why were we being told to stay silent? I told myself it was just a bad year. Maybe the trails were in rough shape after a harsh winter, or maybe we had more inexperienced hikers than usual. Maybe the Park Service was trying to avoid bad press. But then came last Thursday. It was a cloudy afternoon, and I was hiking up the 4-mile trail towards Glacier Point, lost in my thoughts, when something caught my eye. A faint, flickering light, about 50 feet from the trail, beckoned me closer. Curiosity overriding caution, I stepped off the path and pushed through the thick undergrowth. The light led me to a small clearing, where I found a hidden trapdoor, almost invisible beneath a layer of fallen leaves and pine needles. A shiver of apprehension ran down my spine, but I couldn't resist the urge to see what lay beneath. I lifted the trapdoor, revealing a narrow, dirt-walled tunnel. At the far end, a dim light flickered, inviting me deeper into the unknown. Against my better judgment, I descended into the tunnel. The air was thick with the scent of damp earth and decay, and the silence was broken only by the sound of my own ragged breathing. The tunnel opened into a small, earthen chamber. The walls were covered in Polaroid photographs, each one depicting a different hiker on a different trail. And then I saw it, a photo of me, taken just moments before, hiking up a 4-mile trail. Panic surged through me. I turned to flee, but a figure emerged from the shadows, blocking my escape. It was tall and gaunt, its skin pale and translucent, its eyes glowing with an eerie light. I screamed, but the sound was swallowed by the thick earthen walls. The creature lunged at me, its long, skeletal fingers reaching for my throat. I thrashed and kicked, but it was too strong. Its grip tightened, and I felt my consciousness fading. Then, just as suddenly as it had appeared, it vanished. I collapsed to the ground, gasping for air, my body trembling with fear. I scrambled back through the tunnel, desperate to escape the suffocating confines of the chamber. I slammed the trapdoor shut behind me and sprinted back towards the trail. The image of the creature burned into my mind. I didn't stop running until I reached the ranger station, my lungs burning, my legs aching. I burst into my supervisor's office, breathless and terrified, but the words caught in my throat. How could I explain what I had seen? He looked at me with concern, but I knew he wouldn't believe me. So I mumbled something about a family emergency and fled, seeking refuge in the solitude of my own home. But the feeling of being watched persisted. I couldn't shake the feeling that the creature was still out there, lurking in the shadows, waiting for its next victim. And then, this afternoon, I found another Polaroid. It was tucked into the air vent in my living room. It showed me sitting on the couch, reading a book. It was taken this morning. I'm a huge fan of the outdoors. Whenever I get the chance, I'm out there hiking, biking, kayaking, anything to explore. Growing up in the Northeast, I've covered a lot of ground, from the Green Mountains of Vermont to the White Mountains of New Hampshire. But Acadia National Park, with its rugged coastline and mysterious forests, has always held a special allure. So, last August, with the summer sun shining bright and a week of clear skies ahead, I set off on a solo biking trip to Acadia. I arrived in Bar Harbor, Maine, the charming coastal town that serves as a gateway to the park, and immediately felt the pull of the wild. The next morning, I loaded up my trusty old Cannondale mountain bike, a bike that had been my faithful companion on countless adventures, and hit the trails. My first destination was Cadillac Mountain, the highest point on the eastern seaboard. The ride was exhilarating, with breathtaking views of the rocky coastline, the vast expanse of the Atlantic Ocean, and the forested islands scattered along the horizon. I even spotted a bald eagle soaring overhead, its majestic wingspan casting a shadow on the sun-drenched landscape. As I coasted down the mountain, the wind whipping through my hair, I felt a sense of freedom and exhilaration that only comes from being completely immersed in nature. This was what I lived for. I set up camp in a secluded spot near Sand Beach, eager to explore the park's more remote corners. After a simple dinner cooked over a crackling campfire, I settled into my tent with a good book, the sound of the waves crashing against the shore lulling me to sleep. The next morning, I packed up and headed towards the Skootik Peninsula, a less visited section of the park known for its dramatic cliffs and secluded coves. I found an overgrown trail, barely visible beneath a carpet of moss and fallen leaves, and decided to see where it led. The trail was steep and challenging, but I was determined to conquer it. As I climbed higher, the forest grew denser, the air thick with the scent of pine needles and damp earth. I hadn't seen another person for hours. Then, I stumbled upon it, an old, abandoned ranger station, hidden deep within the woods. Its weathered wooden walls and boarded-up windows hinted at a long-forgotten past. Curiosity piqued, I cautiously approached the station. The front door creaked open, revealing a dark and dusty interior. I stepped inside, my heart pounding with a mix of excitement and apprehension. The station was small, with a single room and a narrow staircase leading to a basement. Cobwebs hung from the rafters, and the air was thick with the smell of mildew and decay. As I was about to leave, I heard a noise from the basement, a low moan, like someone in pain. "Hello?" I called out, my voice echoing in the stillness. Is anyone down there? The moan came again, followed by a faint, gurgled plea. Help me. Fear pricked my skin, but I couldn't ignore the cry for help. I switched on my flashlight and descended the creaking basement stairs, each step sending shivers down my spine. The basement was a dimly lit, dirt-floored room. In the flickering beam of my flashlight, I saw a horrifying sight. A woman was chained to the wall, her body covered in cuts and bruises, her clothes ragged and blood-stained. Her eyes were white with terror, and her lips moved in a silent plea for help. I rushed towards her, but a figure emerged from the shadows, blocking my path. It was tall and gaunt, its skin pale and translucent, its eyes glowing with an eerie light. I screamed, but the sound was trapped within the thick stone walls. The creature lunged at me, its long, skeletal fingers reaching for my throat. I struggled, but it was too strong. Its grip tightened, and I felt my consciousness slipping away. Then, as quickly as it appeared, it vanished. I collapsed to the ground, gasping for air, my body trembling. Driven by pure terror, I scrambled back up the stairs and out of the ranger station. I didn't stop running until I reached the main road, where I collapsed, exhausted and terrified. A kind elderly woman driving by stopped to help me. She took me to the nearest hospital, where I was treated for my injuries. The police interviewed me, but when they searched the area I described, they found nothing. No ranger station, no woman, no creature. They dismissed my story as a hallucination, a product of my injuries and the trauma I had endured. But I know what I saw. I know those creatures are out there, lurking in the uncharted territories of Acadia National Park. And I fear they won't stop until they've claimed another victim. Last year, sick of the daily grind, I embarked on my first real vacation, a cross-country road trip on a vintage Vespa scooter. Fueled by a foolish sense of optimism and a thirst for adventure, I set out to explore the western United States. It was a journey that challenged everything I thought I knew about the world. Seattle was a blast, with its vibrant neighborhoods and the quirky charm of Pike Place Market. The Fremont Troll was a definite highlight. Gotta love a city that embraces the weird and wonderful. Leaving Seattle, however, proved to be a navigational nightmare. Confined to back roads by my Vespa's leisurely pace, I got hopelessly lost despite the best efforts of bewildered gas station attendants. "Honey," one kind lady drawled, "you're gonna be riding the thing till next Christmas if you keep heading that way." She pointed me in the general direction of south, with a vague wave of her hand towards the Cascade foothills. By nightfall, I was still hopelessly lost and starting to panic. My Vespa was low on gas, and I hadn't seen another sign of civilization for hours. Just endless miles of winding roads, dense forests, and the occasional glimpse of a snow-capped mountain peak in the distance. Just as I was about to abandon all hope and curl up under a tree for the night, I stumbled upon a dirt road that seemed to lead into the heart of the forest. Figuring I had nothing to lose, I turned onto the path, my Vespa bumping along the uneven terrain. The road eventually led to a clearing, where I discovered a primitive campground, complete with a fire pit, a picnic table, and a dilapidated outhouse. It wasn't much, but it was shelter, and I was grateful for it. I pitched my tent in the fading light, the only camper in sight. After a simple dinner of trail mix and a granola bar, I recorded my usual travel log entry by headlamp light before turning in for the night. I don't know how long I slept, but a strange sound jolted me awake. I sat up, heart pounding, straining to hear what had disturbed my sleep. A soft thud, like something brushing against the side of my tent. Then another, and another. Whatever was out there was circling my tent, slowly and deliberately. I'd encountered plenty of curious critters on my trip, raccoons, squirrels, even a skunk or two, but this felt different. This felt predatory. I held my breath, listening intently. The sound stopped. Silence. Then, a slow, deliberate scratching on the tent fabric, right beside my head. I gasped, scrambling back from the sound. Whatever was out there was big, and it was close. Too close. My mind raced. Bear? Cougar? Something worse? I had no weapon, no protection. Just the thin nylon walls of my tent separating me from whatever lurked outside. Suddenly, the scratching stopped. I held my breath, waiting, listening. Nothing. Maybe it was gone. Then, a low growl, deep and guttural, vibrated through the tent floor. I flinched, my heart hammering against my ribs. Whatever it was still there, and it was hungry. I had to get out of there. 30 yards away, the outhouse beckoned, a small, sturdy structure that might offer some protection. I made a decision. I would make a run for it. Taking a deep breath, I slowly unzipped the tent, wincing at the loud rasp of the zipper. I peered out cautiously. Nothing. No sign of whatever had been terrorizing me. I slipped out of the tent, my bare feet sinking into the cool, damp grass. I crept towards the outhouse, my heart pounding in my ears. The clearing was bathed in moonlight, casting long, eerie shadows from the surrounding trees. I reached the outhouse and fumbled for the latch. The door creaked open, revealing the dark, foul-smelling interior. I didn't care. It was shelter. I slipped inside, slamming the door shut behind me and sliding the bolt into place. I leaned against the rough wooden wall, my breath coming in ragged gasps. I was safe. For now. But as I stood there in the darkness, listening to the sounds of the night, a new fear crept over me. I wasn't alone. A soft voice, barely a whisper, drifted from the corner of the outhouse. Hello? I froze, my blood turning to ice. The voice was feminine, soft and gentle. But there was something undeniably eerie about it. Something inhuman. Who's there? I whispered, my voice trembling. I'm here, the voice replied. I strained my eyes, trying to pierce the darkness, but I couldn't see anything. Who are you? I asked, my voice barely above a whisper. I'm you, the voice said. A wave of terror washed over me. I stumbled back, my hand reaching for the door latch. But it was too late. The door swung open, revealing a figure standing in the moonlight. It was me. but not me. It was taller, thinner, its skin pale and translucent. Its eyes glowed with an unnatural light, and its mouth was stretched into a wide, grotesque smile. I screamed, my voice echoing through the empty campground. The figure lunged at me, its hands reaching for my throat. I clawed at its face, but it was too strong. Its grip tightened, and I felt my vision fading. Then, just as suddenly as it had appeared, it vanished. I collapsed to the ground, gasping for air, my body trembling with fear. I didn't sleep for the rest of the night. I huddled in the corner of the outhouse, my eyes fixed on the door, waiting for the creature to return. But it didn't. When the first rays of dawn appeared, I cautiously emerged from my hiding place. The campground was empty. My Vespa was still there, but my tent was gone. And so was the creature. I packed up my remaining belongings and fled, my heart pounding in my chest. I didn't look back. I didn't dare. I never went back to that campground. I never even went camping again. The memory of that night, the voice in the outhouse, the creature that looked like me, it haunted my dreams for months. I still don't know what I encountered that night. Was it a ghost? A demon? A figment of my imagination? I don't know. And I don't want to know. All I know is that there's something inhuman south of Seattle, something that lurks in the shadows, waiting for unsuspecting travelers. Something that can mimic your voice, your appearance, your very essence. So if you're ever in that part of the country, be careful. And whatever you do, don't go camping alone. This is my first-hand account of a terrifying experience I had in the Wyoming backcountry in 2019. I haven't told anyone about it except my therapist and my best friend. Even after countless therapy sessions and attempts at exposure therapy, the memory still haunts me. Maybe writing it all down will help me find some peace. It all started when I was 25. I've been saving up for a solo backcountry camping trip in the Wyoming wilderness. I live on the East Coast, and while my job paid decently, I picked up odd jobs to help fund the adventure. I also had a friend connect me with their uncle, a seasoned pilot named Mark, who offered to fly me to and from my campsite. Looking back, that was my first mistake. I had minimal camping experience, mostly just weekend trips to state parks and a few Boy Scout excursions. But Mark assured me he knew some remote yet accessible spots, perfect for a beginner like me. He emphasized that these spots were still backcountry and that reaching civilization on foot would be a challenging multi-day trek. My parents helped me gather emergency supplies, food, water, a first aid kit, bear spray, the works. Mark even lent me a rifle, just in case. I'd done some hunting as a teenager, so I knew my way around firearms. The plan was simple. Mark would drop me off at my campsite. I'd spend 5 days exploring the wilderness, and he'd pick me up on day 6. I didn't want to use up all my vacation time, so I kept the trip short and sweet. Mark helped me choose a campsite based on my experience level. He usually flew in hunters and anglers to more rugged areas, but he knew a spot that was relatively flat, with a small lake and stunning mountain views. It sounded idyllic. I won't disclose the exact location. Mark refuses to take anyone there anymore, and as far as I know, it doesn't even have an official name. Besides, the memories associated with that place are so disturbing that I'd rather not revisit them, even in my mind. After Mark dropped me off and helped unload my gear, I spent the first day setting up camp. I found a perfect spot near the lake with a dry log for firewood. A short distance away, I found a grove of trees where I could hang my food to keep it safe from bears. The next couple of days were uneventful, filled with the peaceful solitude of the wilderness. I watched a moose wade into the lake, hiked to a hilltop to observe a herd of elk, and even found an old, rusted boat that I dragged back to my campsite for a potential photo op. But on day four, things took a sinister turn. An unsettling silence fell over the wilderness. The birds stopped singing, and the only sounds were the gentle lapping of the lake against the shore and the incessant buzzing of mosquitoes. I retreated to my tent, trying to ignore the growing sense of unease. As darkness descended, my anxiety intensified. I built a larger campfire than usual, hoping the extra light would ward off whatever was lurking in the shadows. I kept my bear spray and rifle close at hand, but sleep wouldn't come. The silence was unnerving, and every creak and rustle of the forest sent shivers down my spine. Just as I was drifting off, a sharp crack echoed through the stillness. I jolted awake, my heart pounding. Something was moving through my campsite. I grabbed the bear spray, my knuckles white around the canister. Slowly, I turned my head and saw a shadow cast on the tent wall, illuminated by the moonlight. It was an animal, large and imposing, about the size of a grizzly bear. But the shape seemed off. The creature emitted a series of huffing sounds, like a bear, but with a strange, guttural undertone. It was getting closer. I held my breath, my thumb hovering over the safety catch of the bear spray. Suddenly, the creature ripped through the tent, its jaws clamping down on my sleeping bag. I was thrown to the ground, my head spinning. For a fleeting moment, I saw its face. It was bear-like, but with an uncanny distortion, a subtle rawness that I couldn't quite place. As the creature dragged me from the tent, I fumbled with the bear spray, finally managing to unleash a cloud of burning pepper spray into its face. It roared in pain, a sound that sent chills down my spine, and retreated into the darkness. I scrambled to my feet, my heart pounding, and ran towards the lake. I remembered the old boat and frantically pushed it into the water, paddling away from the shore as fast as I could. The creature emerged from the trees, its silhouette illuminated by the fading campfire. It waded into the lake, its eyes fixed on me with a chilling intensity. But it stopped at the shallows, seemingly unwilling to venture deeper. I watched in horror as it turned and charged towards my campsite, tearing through my tent and scattering my belongings. I prayed that my satellite phone and rifle were still intact. I huddled in the boat, shivering in my wet clothes, unable to sleep. The creature's terrifying roars echoed across the lake, a constant reminder of its presence. As dawn broke, I was still too afraid to return to my campsite. I waited until noon, my stomach growling with hunger, before cautiously paddling back to shore. The campsite was a disaster. My tent was shredded, my sleeping bag ripped to shreds, and my belongings scattered everywhere. The rifle was damaged, its stock cracked. My food cache was gone. I salvaged what I could, a small backpack, some clothes, my binoculars, one lens cracked, the satellite phone, and a few emergency flares. I kept glancing over my shoulder, expecting the creature to reappear at any moment. As I reached for my bear spray, a low growl rumbled from the thicket. I froze, my blood turning to ice. The creature emerged from the trees. It was bear-like, but with a disturbingly uncanny quality, as if it were a distorted reflection of a real bear. Its movements were fluid and unnatural, its eyes burning with an eerie intelligence. I threw a flare at it, hoping to scare it off. It recoiled momentarily, giving me a chance to run for the boat. I paddled frantically, but the creature followed me along the shoreline, its growls echoing across the water. I spotted a fallen log jutting out from the shore and steered the boat towards it, hoping to find a temporary refuge. But as I reached the log, I realized the creature was gone. I let out a sigh of relief, but it was short-lived. I accidentally kicked my foot against the log, and the creature reappeared, roaring with renewed fury. I searched the boat frantically for something, anything, to defend myself with. Under the seat, I found a metal box containing a vintage camping shovel. It wasn't much, but it was better than nothing. I paddled down the lake towards a river, the creature stalking me along the shore. I pulled up the satellite phone and called Mark, my voice trembling with fear. He assured me he was on his way and told me to keep an eye on the bear. As darkness fell, I was enveloped in a cold, terrifying solitude. I somehow managed to fall asleep, waking only once to the sound of something moving near the boat. When dawn broke, I found myself drifting towards the shore. The creature was gone. I gathered my meager belongings and, following Mark's instructions, set off on foot towards our prearranged meeting point. The trek was agonizing. Every rustle of leaves, every snapping twig, sent my heart racing. I was hyper-aware of my surroundings, constantly scanning the trees for any sign of the creature. Finally, I reached the meadow where Mark was waiting for me. I sprinted towards the plain, my relief palpable. Mark helped me load my gear, his rifle at the ready. Just as we were about to take off, the creature emerged from the trees, roaring and charging towards us. Mark quickly started the engine and took off, the creature's frustrated roars fading into the distance. "I don't know what that was," Mark said, his voice shaking, "but that wasn't a bear." Back in civilization, I tried to describe the creature to wildlife officials, but the words wouldn't come. The memory was too vivid, too disturbing. They dismissed it as a bear encounter. But Mark and I knew better. We had seen something truly uncanny, something that defied explanation. And we both knew that we would never forget it. This is the first in a series of unsettling events I experienced one summer in Montana. I grew up in the northern part of the state, hiking through its vast forests in the summer and snowboarding down its snow-covered slopes in the winter. Montana, in my opinion, is one of the most beautiful states in the U.S., with its diverse landscapes, abundant wildlife, historic towns, and friendly locals. Everyone has a story to tell, and those stories, whether good or bad, always held a certain charm. But lately, something strange has been happening. It started subtly, with odd occurrences that, at first, didn't seem out of the ordinary. Every now and then, you'd encounter a peculiar character, usually someone who had fallen victim to the ever-growing drug problem that plagued our small communities. Or maybe you'd spot a strange-looking animal lurking by the roadside late at night, its form shifting in the shadows, making you question whether it was a dog, a coyote, or something else entirely. But this man was different. He was unsettling. It was an ordinary afternoon in early June. I was working at a small shop that sold touristy trinkets, bored out of my mind as I watched the clock tick by. We were unusually slow for a summer day. Around 2 p.m., he walked in. He was accompanied by two people, a couple who seemed vaguely familiar. Judging by their conversations, I doubted he knew them very well. Maybe he was a tour guide. The couple wandered off to browse our merchandise, while he lingered near the community board, his gaze fixed on the various flyers and announcements. I didn't pay much attention to him at first. He seemed utterly ordinary, forgettable even. Painfully normal, I thought to myself, glancing in his direction. That was my first mistake. His head snapped up, his eyes meeting mine as if he had heard my thoughts. It was as if he hadn't encountered another human being in ages. He approached the cash register with an unnatural, almost robotic gait. And then I saw him clearly. He was no longer ordinary. Something about him was distinctly off. His face was stretched into an unsettling smile, a little too wide, a little too eager. His eyes were vacant, devoid of any discernible emotion or thought. Staring into them was like peering into an abyss, a void of pure malice. He mumbled something, a string of sounds that didn't quite resemble English. What was that? I asked, forcing a cheerful customer service tone, though his presence was suffocating me. His unsettling smile vanished in an instant, replaced by a chilling blankness. I had somehow angered him. "Nothing," he muttered, turning away. I felt a wave of relief wash over me as he retreated. But the unsettling feeling remained. I never saw him leave. The couple exited about 30 minutes later, but he wasn't with them. Even when I closed up that night, he was nowhere to be found. A week later, a foul odor began to permeate the shop, emanating from the small crawl space above our tea towel section. Something had been stewing in the oppressive June heat. My manager, assuming it was a dead bird or squirrel that had found its way into the attic, grabbed a flashlight and told me to go up and investigate. I half expected to find the man, or creature, from the other day. But the attic was empty. The only things I found were blood and an old pocket knife that looked like it had been dropped by a maintenance worker. The stench dissipated in the following days, and the incident was soon forgotten by the rest of the staff. But I couldn't shake the memory of the man who never left, the blood in the attic, the feeling of unease that clung to me like a shroud. That encounter instilled a fear in me I had never known before. Growing up on horror movies, I thought I was immune to fear. But this was different. This man, this thing, truly terrified me. I had looked into the face of evil, and the memory would haunt me forever. It left me with a lingering paranoia, a fear of the ordinary, of the seemingly harmless stranger. Every time a new customer walked in, I couldn't help but wonder if they were hiding a dark secret. Days later, I found myself drawn back to the attic. Something compelled me to return, though I couldn't explain why. My ascent up the creaking ladder was agonizingly slow, each step feeling heavy, as if I were wading through thick molasses. And there he was, sprawled in the dusty attic, his lifeless eyes staring blankly at the rafters. Dead. The police attributed his death to a drug overdose, a convenient explanation that everyone readily accepted. But I knew better. Something more sinister was at play, something I didn't want to understand. It was a typical Friday night, and I was hanging out with my friend Chris. Now, Chris, he's a bit of a wild card. Not in a mean or dangerous way, but definitely impulsive and always up for something crazy. We met back in sixth grade, shortly after I moved to town. I was shy and awkward, struggling to make friends, but Chris, with his infectious energy and knack for trouble, pulled me out of my shell. He was always the one talking me into doing stupid stuff, the kind of stuff that landed us in detention more often than not. But despite his penchant for trouble, Chris was a good friend. We shared the same geeky interests, and I genuinely enjoyed our adventures, even if they sometimes pushed the boundaries of common sense. Anyway, this happened last year, when I was 16. Chris suggested we head into the woods near his house late one night. I wasn't thrilled about the idea. It was pitch black, and I had a creepy feeling about those woods, but Chris can be pretty persuasive. So, around midnight, we snuck out of his house, his parents were out of town, and ventured into the darkness. The deeper we went, the more uneasy I felt. There was a strange atmosphere in those woods, a heavy presence that made the hairs on the back of my neck stand on end. About an hour into our trek, I stumbled upon something bizarre, a VHS tape, lying on the ground beneath a tree. I picked it up, the plastic case cold and damp in my hand. The label simply read Wrath with the date 1995 scrawled beneath it. Chris was intrigued. He told me he had an old VCR in his basement, and since his parents were away, we could watch the tape. Curiosity got the better of me, and I agreed. Back at his house, we hooked up the VCR, popped in the tape, and sat down, bracing ourselves for whatever disturbing content might be on it. The tape started with a scene of six children, three boys and three girls, playing in the woods. The woods looked eerily similar to the ones where we'd found the tape, which made me wonder if it had been filmed there. A man's voice could be heard off camera, talking to the children in a friendly, almost playful tone, like the host of a kid's show. Occasionally, his hand would come into view, wearing a blue and green mitten. He must have been dressed up as some kind of animal. Then, the scene abruptly changed. The children were now tied up, their faces filled with terror. The man chanted something in a language I didn't recognize, then struck a match and tossed it into the center of the circle of children. The kids screamed and struggled against their bonds as the flames engulfed them. The tape ended with the fire dying down, the children's screams fading into silence. I felt sick to my stomach. Chris looked equally disturbed. The next day, I took the tape to the police. They said they'd investigate, but months passed, and I heard nothing. Then, last week, Chris disappeared. The police searched for a day, then called it off, saying they found no trace of him. I've been researching missing children cases from 1995, trying to find any information about the incident on the tape. If anyone knows anything about a child murder involving a kid show host in Northern California around that time, please let me know. I'm scared. I can't shake the feeling that I'm next. The air hung heavy with the scent of damp earth and decaying leaves, a thick, earthy perfume that clung to the back of Rachel's throat. Sunlight, a pale ghost of itself, filtered through the dense canopy of trees, casting the forest floor in a perpetual twilight. Rachel, or Panda as her friends knew her, shivered, pulling her worn denim jacket tighter around her. It wasn't the chill that set her teeth on edge, it was the silence, a deep, expectant hush that seemed to press in from all sides. "This is it," she whispered, her voice barely audible above the soft sigh of the wind. "This is where a mystery begins." Beside her, Ben, his lanky frame swallowed by an oversized hoodie, shuffled his feet, kicking up a cloud of dust. "Mystery?" he scoffed, his voice tinged with nervous bravado. "More like a recipe for getting lost." "Don't be such a wimp, Ben," Violet chided, her purple-streaked hair a splash of defiance against the muted greens and browns of the forest. "Besides, Panda's right. This town is suffocating us with its normalcy. We need a little chaos." Jules, ever the quiet observer, nodded his agreement, his gaze fixed on the shadowy depths of the woods. Only Lucy, her eyes alight with a mischievous glint, seemed genuinely enthralled by the prospect of their adventure. "Let's give them something to talk about," she urged, her voice a conspiratorial whisper. "Let's give them a mystery they'll never forget." Their plan, hatched in the boredom of countless summer afternoons, was as audacious as it was reckless. They would weave a tapestry of intrigue, a web of cryptic clues and unsettling events that would send shivers down the spines of their small town. Fake footprints leading into the heart of the forest, strange symbols carved into the bark of ancient trees, whispers of a shadowy figure lurking in the shadows. They would use the forest as their canvas, painting a picture of mystery and fear. As they ventured deeper into the woods, the air grew thick with an almost palpable sense of anticipation. The towering trees, their gnarled branches reaching out like skeletal arms, seemed to close ranks around them, shutting out the world beyond. The silence deepened, broken only by the occasional snap of a twig or the distant cry of a hawk. And in the shadows, unseen eyes watched their every move, their presence a silent promise of the darkness to come. The forest floor, a tapestry of moss-covered roots and fallen leaves, became their testing ground. Panda, with a gleam of mischief in her eyes, devised a series of challenges designed to push her friends beyond their comfort zones. "First up," she announced, her voice ringing with authority, "the Cave of Whispers." A collective groan arose from the group. The Cave of Whispers, a narrow fissure in the rocky hillside, was shrouded in local legend, rumored to be haunted by the spirits of lost travelers. Ben, his face pale, swallowed hard. Violet, however, met Panda's gaze with a spark of defiance. "Fine," she declared, her voice steady. "But if I hear any whispers, I'm blaming you." One by one, they ventured into the cave's maw, their flashlights cutting through the thick darkness. Then, his heart pounding in his chest, Imagine ghostly figures lurking in the shadows, their whispers echoing through the narrow passage. Violet, her senses heightened, felt a strange energy thrumming within the cave, a primal pulse that resonated with her own rebellious spirit. Jules, ever the pragmatist, examined the cave walls, his keen eyes searching for geological formations or signs of animal habitation. He noted the subtle changes in air temperature, the dampness clinging to the rocks, the faint scent of minerals and decay. Lucy, however, seemed to thrive in the darkness. She moved with an uncanny grace, her laughter echoing off the cave walls, a playful taunt to the unseen forces that might dwell within. Emerging from the cave, blinking in the sudden sunlight, they shared their experiences, their voices hushed with a mixture of fear and exhilaration. The shared challenge had forged a bond between them, a sense of camaraderie that transcended their individual anxieties. Next, Panda led them to the tallest tree in the forest, a towering sentinel that seemed to pierce the heavens. The challenge: climb to the top and retrieve a small flag she had planted there earlier. Ben, his fear of heights battling with his desire to impress Violet, reluctantly agreed. Violet, fearless as ever, scaled the tree with the agility of a seasoned climber. Jules, methodical and cautious, made his way up slowly, his eyes scanning for secure handholds. And Lucy, with a mischievous grin, raced ahead, her laughter echoing through the branches. As they descended, flushed with triumph, they felt a surge of confidence. They had faced their fears, tested their limits, and emerged stronger as a team. But as the sun began to set, casting long shadows across the forest floor, a sense of unease crept in. They had pushed the boundaries of their comfort zones, but in doing so, they had also awakened something within the woods, something ancient and watchful, that now followed their every move. The flickering flames of the campfire painted grotesque shadows on the faces of the red blood detectives, their expressions a mix of excitement and apprehension. Panda, her eyes shining with an almost manic intensity, unveiled the final act of their grand deception, a staged kidnapping. "We'll leave a trail of misleading clues," she explained, her voice charged with a thrill that bordered on dangerous. "A struggle, signs of forced entry, maybe even a few drops of fake blood." Ben, ever the voice of reason, shifted uneasily. "Isn't this a bit much, Panda? What if someone actually believes we've been kidnapped?" "That's the whole point, Benny boy," Violet interjected, a sly grin curving her lips. "We'll let the town stew in their fear for a while, then make a dramatic reappearance with a harrowing tale of escape. We'll be legends." Jules, his brow furrowed in thought, voiced a practical concern. "Where will we hide? We can't just disappear without a trace." "Leave that to me," Lucy chirped, her voice laced with a chilling confidence that sent shivers down Ben's spine. "I know a place, an old abandoned mine shaft deep in the woods. Nobody ever goes there." A wave of unease washed over the group. The mine shaft, shrouded in local lore and whispered tales of tragedy, was a place of darkness and dread. Even Violet, with her usual fearlessness, felt a tremor of apprehension. "Are you sure about this, Lucy?" she asked, her voice barely a whisper. Lucy's smile widened, a predator's glint in her eyes. "Trust me, Vi. It'll be perfect." As they planned the details of their disappearance, a sense of foreboding settled over the group. The playful excitement of their earlier escapades had evaporated, replaced by a nervous tension that crackled in the air. Ben, his apprehension growing, tried to voice his concerns, but Panda, fueled by a desperate need for recognition, brushed them aside. She was determined to see their plan through, no matter the cost. But as the night wore on and the fire dwindled to embers, a chilling realization dawned on them. Lucy was gone. She had vanished without a trace, leaving behind only a lingering sense of unease and the faint echo of her laughter, hanging heavy in the still night air. Panic gnawed at the edges of their bravado. Lucy's disappearance, so sudden and inexplicable, cast a pall over the group. The playful game had taken a sinister turn, the forest no longer a playground but a hunting ground. Lucy! Panda's voice, sharp with fear, cut through the oppressive silence. Lucy, where are you? Her calls echoed unanswered, swallowed by the dense undergrowth. The remaining members of the Red Blood Detectives exchanged anxious glances, their eyes wide with a growing sense of dread. We need to find her, Ben urged, his voice trembling slightly. Something's not right. They fanned out, their flashlights cutting through the darkness, searching for any sign of their missing friend. The forest, once familiar, now seemed alien and hostile, its shadows teeming with unseen threats. Violet, her senses heightened, noticed a faint trail of disturbed leaves and broken branches leading deeper into the woods. A sense of foreboding washed over her, a primal instinct warning her of danger. Jules, ever observant, spotted a glint of metal half hidden beneath a pile of leaves. He cautiously approached, his heart pounding in his chest, and uncovered a small pocket knife, its blade stained a dark, ominous red. A collective gasp arose from the group. The blood, still wet, sent a chill down their spines. This was no longer a game. This was real. As they pressed on, the forest seemed to close in on them, its silence broken by the occasional snap of a twig or the rustle of leaves. They imagined eyes watching them from the shadows, unseen figures lurking just beyond the reach of their flashlights. Then, a sound pierced the oppressive quiet, a scream, muffled but undeniably human. It came from the direction of the abandoned mine shaft, Lucy's chillingly perfect hiding spot. They raced towards the source of the sound, their hearts pounding in their chests, fear fueling their every step. As they approached the mine shaft, a figure emerged from the darkness, silhouetted against the pale moonlight. It was Lucy. But something was different. Her eyes, once sparkling with mischief, were now wide and vacant, filled with a chilling emptiness. Her clothes were torn, her hair disheveled, and in her hand, she clutched a blood-soaked hunting knife. A wave of horror washed over the group. They had found Lucy, but the girl they knew was gone, replaced by something dark and sinister, something that sent shivers of fear down their spines. The sight of Lucy standing there, bathed in the pale moonlight, a blood-soaked knife clutched in her hand, stopped me dead in my tracks. My breath caught in my throat, a wave of shock, confusion, and fear washing over me. Lucy, what happened? I managed to stammer, trying to mask the tremor in my voice. She didn't answer. Instead, a twisted grin spread across her face, a chillingly unfamiliar expression that made my blood run cold. Her eyes, once sparkling with mischief, were now vacant, hollow, like those of a lifeless doll. This isn't funny, Lucy. Ben's voice cut through the tense silence. Put the knife down. A low, chilling chuckle escaped her lips. You think this is a game? It's not a game anymore. What do you mean? Violet asked, her voice trembling. Lucy took a step closer, her shadow stretching towards us like a grasping claw. I mean, I killed John. And now I'm going to kill all of you. Her words struck us like a physical blow. None of us could have imagined that our sweet, playful friend was capable of such a horrific act. You're insane, Lucy. Jules yelled, backing away. Yes, I am, she shrieked, her voice echoing through the trees. And you're all going to die. She lunged at Jules, the knife raised high. Ben reacted instantly, throwing himself between them. They grappled, a whirlwind of limbs and desperate struggle. Violet, the others, and I, we ran. We ran for our lives. We scrambled through the darkness, the sounds of Lucy's crazed laughter and Ben's desperate cries echoing behind us. We headed for the old abandoned cabin, hoping for shelter, for safety. But when we reached it, the door was locked from the outside, and a faint smell of gasoline hung in the air. Oh no! I gasped. It's a trap. Suddenly, flames erupted, engulfing the cabin in a fiery embrace. We were trapped, with nowhere to go. Help! Our screams for help were swallowed by the roaring flames. No one could hear us. The fire raged, the heat unbearable, the smoke choking. One by one, we succumbed, our consciousness fading into the suffocating darkness. The flames roared, consuming the old wooden cabin, reducing it to nothing but ash and cinders. No cries for help, no struggling figures, only the crackling of fire and the ominous plume of black smoke rising against the dark sky. It felt like the end, not just of the cabin, but of everything. The next morning, they came. Police cars, flashing lights cutting through the early morning mist, and the grim faces of firefighters sifting through the debris. They found us, or what was left of us. Our lifeless bodies lay scattered amongst the charred remains, a grim tableau of a night gone horribly wrong. The news of our deaths spread like wildfire through our small town. Shock, disbelief, and grief hung heavy in the air. Families shattered, friends devastated, a community forever scarred. No one ever truly understood what happened that night. Some whispered of a tragic accident, others of a sinister plot. But the truth, the real horror of it, remained buried beneath the ashes, a chilling secret that would linger in the shadows. Our story, the story of the blood-red detectives, became a local legend, a cautionary tale whispered around campfires. Some say our spirits still haunt the woods, forever searching for answers, forever trapped in the nightmare that claimed our lives. And I, or what's left of me, I'm still here. A silent observer, a ghost trapped in the echoes of that terrible night. A chilling reminder of the darkness that lurks within us all, the darkness that can consume, destroy, and leave nothing but ashes and unanswered questions. Let me set the scene. I'm 17, name's Alex, and I live in a small, kind of isolated neighborhood in northern West Virginia. It's called Black Creek, and it used to be a bustling mining community back in the late 1800s. But when the mines closed down, most of the families moved away to find work, leaving behind a ghost town vibe. You can still see remnants of the past scattered around, abandoned houses, a couple of old churches, one for whites, one for blacks. Yeah, it was that kind of place back then, and even some old mine shafts that run beneath the neighborhood. I haven't actually found any of the entrances, though. They were all sealed up decades ago after a few too many kids got lost or hurt exploring them. Anyway, I thought I knew Black Creek like the back of my hand. I'd explored every nook and cranny, every abandoned building, every overgrown trail. Or so I thought. About a week ago, just before school was about to start, I decided to go for a hike. I was wandering along a trail near my house when I decided to veer off the path and head towards a line of old power lines in the distance. That's when I saw it. A house. It wasn't anything special, just a small, dilapidated farmhouse, but it caught me off guard. I'd never seen it before, which was weird considering how close it was to the trail. It was like it had just materialized out of thin air. The house was painted a faded blue, with most of the windows boarded up or broken. Inside, it was a mess, ripped wallpaper, holes in the walls, a crumbling chimney. The only door that was still intact was the front door, but it didn't even latch. Despite the house being pretty unremarkable, I couldn't shake this creepy feeling I had. It was like a wave of paranoia washed over me the moment I stepped inside. Like I was somewhere I shouldn't be, like I was being watched. I continued exploring, my unease growing with every step. And then I saw them. Those eyes. Peering up at me through a hole in the floor. My stomach lurched, and I almost threw up. They were dark blue, almost black, and surrounded by long, tangled strands of what looked like hair. Whoever, or whatever, was down there didn't blink. It just stared. I instinctively reached for the haunting knife I always carried on my belt. I mean, who the heck just stares at you from a hole in the floor? When I looked back, the eyes were gone. I thought maybe I'd imagined it, so I went to check out the hole. But the second I got close, I heard heavy footsteps pounding up the basement stairs. Fight or flight kicked in, and I bolted out of there. I jumped off the porch, ignoring the jolt of pain in my ankles as I landed, and sprinted back towards the trail. I didn't stop running until I reached my house, where I slammed the door shut and locked it, my heart still pounding in my chest. It's been a week now, and I still can't shake the feeling of dread. I keep replaying those eyes in my mind, that sense of being watched, hunted. Tomorrow, I'm going back to the house. I have to know what's down there. My friend Max is coming with me. He's the only one I've told about this, and I'm not even sure he believes me. But I need someone there, just in case. I'll keep you guys updated. Wish me luck. My buddies and I are all about exploring the great outdoors. We crave it, we thrive in it. Whether it's the forests of Oregon, the Rocky Mountains, or the deserts of Nevada, we're always up for a good adventure. Usually, we stick to the woods, but back in 2020, During the peak of the lockdown, my friend Alex and I decided to head to Arizona. We were going stir-crazy cooped up inside, and escaping to the wilderness seemed like the perfect antidote to the pandemic blues. Since we were already living together, hitting the road and venturing into the Arizona desert posed no extra risk to anyone. In fact, it felt like the most responsible thing we could do at the time. Now, whenever we go on these trips, we have this tradition of finding some local legend or spooky story to spice things up. We turn it into a running gag, pretending to hunt for Bigfoot or search for lost treasure. It just makes the whole experience more fun. Hiking for miles can get boring, but if you're on a quest to uncover some hidden mystery, the downtime becomes way more entertaining. I know it sounds silly, but it's our thing. So, when we started looking into Arizona lore, we stumbled upon the Superstition Mountains and their infamous legend of the Lost Dutchman's Gold Mine. Naturally, we had to check it out. For those unfamiliar, the story goes that in the late 1800s, a German explorer named Jacob Waltz, aka the Dutchman, discovered a massive gold mine in the Superstitions, a mine so rich it could make a man wealthy beyond imagination. Walt supposedly knew the exact location but died before he could reveal it or claim any of the gold for himself. Before his death, he hinted that the mine was hidden somewhere near Weaver's Needle, a towering rock formation visible for miles around. So, being the adventurous nerds that we are, we decided to hike the Weaver's Needle Trail, a 13-mile trek that we planned to stretch out over 3 days. It's not the toughest hike in the world, but you need to pack plenty of water, especially in the scorching Arizona summer. We were pumped. It was our first real escape from lockdown, and we had this awesome treasure hunting game to keep us entertained. We even found some goofy hand-drawn maps and riddles online to add to the fun. We loaded up Alex's Jeep with enough food and water to last a week, a giant tent, and all the essential gear, flashlights, binoculars, first aid kit, the works. This trip felt different, like a real escape from the craziness of the world. For a weekend, at least, things would feel normal again. When we arrived at the trailhead, I was surprised by how empty it was. We had expected to see other hikers, but it seemed like everyone was still hesitant to venture out. There was only one other car in the parking lot. As we unloaded our gear, a park ranger approached us and introduced himself. He was a friendly guy, maybe a few years older than us, and seemed genuinely excited to see some actual visitors. We got to chatting, and it turned out we had a lot in common. We ended up talking for almost half an hour, and he gave us some great tips about the trail and must-see views. He even started jokingly complaining about how he wished he could join us instead of being stuck in the ranger station all day. Alex and I, starved for social interaction after months of isolation, jumped at the chance. "Why don't you come with us?" I asked. "We'd love the company." He hesitated at first, saying he didn't want to intrude, but we insisted. We even jokingly tried to shove some cash into his hand. He finally agreed, saying he'd consider it an off-the-books tour, but we had to sign a waiver just in case. We were thrilled. Having a knowledgeable guide along for the adventure made it even more exciting. Before we set off, I gave Alex and the ranger a quick rundown of the clues the Dutchman supposedly left behind. We kept it simple, focusing on the most well-known ones. The mine was located off a trail heading north, You'd pass a stone cabin along the way. There would be a fork in the trail where you had to choose the less obvious path. You'd see a stone wall with Apache carvings. Two prominent rock formations would be visible from the mine entrance. And finally, there was a stone arch that looked like an eye, from which you could see both the mine and Weaver's Needle. We hadn't been hiking for 10 minutes when Alex started joking about keeping an eye out for that stone cabin. The ranger laughed and said, "Please don't tell me you guys are serious about finding the lost Dutchman's mine. I was really starting to like you." We assured him it was all just a bit of fun, and he launched into some fascinating stories about the mine and the Superstition Mountains. He told us about how people had been finding gold in the area since the early 1800s, and how the mountains were shrouded in mystery and danger. Some said the mine was guarded by Apache spirits, others that it was cursed. There were countless stories of people who had vanished in the superstitions, their bodies never found. We were hooked. The ranger's stories brought the legend to life, and the hike felt like a journey through a real-life mystery. As we continued, the conversation died down a bit as the desert heat started to take its toll. After about 2 hours, we entered a narrow passageway between two towering stone walls. It was a welcome respite from the sun, and we lingered for a moment, enjoying the cool shade. On the right side of the trail, nestled against one of the walls, was a crumbling structure that looked like it could have once been a small stone cabin. Alex and I immediately started celebrating, pretending we had found the first clue. We danced around the ruins, pointing at the pile of rocks and acting like we were on the verge of striking it rich. But as we tried to get the ranger to join in our excitement, I noticed he was staring intently at something above us. I followed his gaze, but the sun was directly in my eyes. Just as I shielded my face with my hand, a shadow fell over us, and a massive boulder, shaped like a giant egg, came crashing down from the ledge above. We scattered just in time, narrowly avoiding being crushed. The boulder slammed into the wall, splitting in two and taking a chunk of the wall with it. As the dust settled, I noticed something glinting in the freshly exposed section of the wall. Cold. Not a lot, but definitely cold. Before I could say anything, the ranger drew his pistol and aimed it at the ledge above. It dawned on me that he must have seen someone up there, someone who had deliberately tried to crush us with that boulder. The atmosphere instantly shifted from playful to terrifying. We huddled behind the ranger, our hearts pounding. After what felt like an eternity, he holstered his weapon and motioned for us to follow him out of the passageway. As we hurried away, I couldn't help but glance back at the glimmering gold embedded in the wall. Once we were a safe distance away, Alex blurted out, "Should we go back?" "Absolutely not," the ranger said sharply. "Dude, did you not see the gold in that wall?" I asked, incredulous. "That's fool's gold," he replied dismissively. "Pyrite. Worthless." My gut screamed that he was lying, trying to downplay the discovery so we'd move on and he could return for the gold himself. He must have seen the suspicion in my eyes because he added, "You don't really think that's a sign of the lost Dutchman's mine, do you?" "No, there wasn't much there," Alex said, "but it has to mean we're close, right?" At that moment, our playful treasure hunt turned deadly serious. The ranger's face was etched with concern, but I still wasn't sure if it was genuine. "Listen," he said, holding up his hands. That boulder wasn't a coincidence. Someone or something pushed that rock, and they wanted you to see what was in that wall. Did you see someone up there? I asked, my voice tight. He shook his head, a strange look in his eyes. No, but we need to keep moving. There's a rest stop about a mile ahead. I'll explain everything there. We followed him, the playful mood shattered, replaced by a tense silence. The ranger's words echoed in my mind. Who would want us to find the gold? And why try to kill us? The rest stop was a small, shaded area with a trickling stream. We sat down, exhausted and on edge. The ranger offered to refill our canteens, and as soon as he was out of earshot, Alex whispered, "I have a plan." We agreed to play along with whatever the ranger said, pretending to believe his explanation while secretly continuing our search for the gold. We keep up the treasure hunting charade, but use it as a way to get him to lead us to potential clues. When the ranger returned, he warned us to conserve our water, as the stream was running low. He then launched into a somber speech about the dangers of the superstitions, emphasizing the many people who had disappeared or died in the mountains. He insisted that the gold we had seen was fool's gold, a worthless mineral meant to lure unsuspecting treasure hunters to their doom. He described gruesome discoveries, skeletons with missing skulls, bodies riddled with gunshot wounds. He spoke of a strange, malevolent energy in the mountains, a force that punished those who sought to claim its riches. He begged us to forget about the gold and focus on enjoying the hike. Alex and I nodded solemnly, feigning agreement. We knew he was lying, but we played our parts perfectly. We can still joke about the treasure, though, right? I asked, trying to gauge his reaction. Of course, he said with a forced smile. We can keep up the game. He slapped his thigh and stood up. Now, let's get moving. We need to reach Weaver's Needle before sunset. We followed him, our eyes scanning the landscape for any sign of the clues we had memorized. The trail became steeper, and the heat was relentless. I was starting to lose interest in the gold, focused solely on putting one foot in front of the other. With about an hour of daylight left, we stopped for a brief rest in a patch of shade. As I finally looked up from the trail, I noticed two distinct rock formations jutting out from a nearby hilltop. They looked exactly like the two prominent columns mentioned in the Dutchman's clues. I tried to contain my excitement, but I couldn't help but bounce on the balls of my feet and gesture wildly at the formations. "Hey, look!" I exclaimed, feigning childish enthusiasm. "Those rocks look like giant forks. Can we go up there and take a picture?" The ranger, amused by my antics, agreed to the detour. As we followed him towards the hill, I nudged Alex and subtly pointed at the ground. A faint trail branched off from the main path, heading directly towards the rock formations. "It's the trick of the trail," Alex whispered excitedly. We were now certain that the gold we had seen was real, and that we were on the right track. But we needed a plan to buy ourselves some time at the top of the hill to search for the next clue. The climb was short but strenuous. By the time we reached the peak, I was lightheaded and nauseous from the heat. I sat down, facing the way we had come, hoping to catch my breath. From this vantage point, I could see the passageway with the stone cabin in the distance. As I scanned the area with my binoculars, I noticed some movement near the entrance. I quickly reached for my binoculars, hoping to get a closer look. I focused on the ledge above the passageway, the spot where the boulder had fallen from. And there he was. A man, standing on the ledge, looking directly at me. He wasn't dressed like a hiker. He wore ordinary clothes, jeans, and a t-shirt. But there was something unsettling about him, something I couldn't quite put my finger on. I stared at him through the binoculars, my heart pounding. He didn't seem to notice me at first, but then he tilted his head and raised an eyebrow, as if he knew I was watching him. A wave of dread washed over me. He lifted his hand and gave me a slow, deliberate wave, the kind beauty queens do in pageants. I lowered the binoculars, my hand trembling. The man was gone. I looked around frantically, but there was no sign of him. Had I imagined it? "Alex," I whispered, my voice shaking. "I think we're being watched." My heart hammered in my chest as we scrambled down the hill, the image of those disembodied legs seared into my mind. The darkness was absolute, the only sounds our ragged breathing and the crunch of our boots on the loose gravel. "Where are we going?" Alex gasped, his voice tight with fear. "The arch," I said, my voice barely a whisper. "It's our only chance." The ranger didn't argue. He seemed to be in a state of shock, his face pale and drawn in the flickering light of my flashlight. We stumbled through the darkness, the fear propelling us forward. I couldn't shake the feeling that we were being hunted, that those legs were somewhere out there in the night, closing in on us. After what felt like an eternity, we reached the arch. It loomed above us, a dark silhouette against the star-studded sky. We huddled together beneath it, our breaths coming in short gasps. "What now?" Alex whispered, his eyes white with fear. "I didn't know. I had no plan." We were trapped, lost in a nightmare world of shadows and whispers. Suddenly, the ranger spoke, his voice hoarse and trembling. "There's something you need to know about the mine," he said. "It's not just gold that's hidden there." We stared at him, our fear momentarily forgotten. "What do you mean?" I asked. He hesitated, his gaze darting from side to side. "It's a gateway," he finally said. "A portal to somewhere else." "Somewhere else?" Alex repeated, his voice incredulous. The ranger nodded. "I've seen it," he said. "I've seen things, things you wouldn't believe." He described a swirling vortex of colors, a portal that shimmered and pulsed in the depths of the mine. He said it was guarded by creatures, things that weren't human, things that preyed on fear and desperation. "The gold is just a lure," he said, his voice barely above a whisper. "It draws people in, tempts them to cross over to their doom." I felt a chill run down my spine. The pieces of the puzzle were starting to fall into place. The strange occurrences, the disembodied legs, the hermit, it all pointed to something far more sinister than a simple gold mine. "What about the Dutchman?" I asked. "Did he cross over?" The ranger shook his head. "No," he said, He escaped, but he was never the same. He spent the rest of his life trying to warn people to keep them away from the mine, but no one believed him. He looked at us, his eyes filled with a desperate plea. "You have to leave," he said. "You have to get out of these mountains before it's too late." But it was already too late. As he spoke, a low growl echoed through the archway, a sound that seemed to vibrate in the very air around us. We turned to see a figure emerging from the shadows, a tall, skeletal creature with glowing red eyes. It lunged at us, its claws outstretched. We screamed and scrambled back, but it was too fast. It grabbed a ranger, its claws sinking into his flesh. He screamed in agony as the creature dragged him into the darkness. Alex and I were paralyzed with fear, our bodies frozen in place. We watched helplessly as the creature disappeared into the depths of the archway, the ranger's screams echoing in our ears. Then, silence. We stood there for a long moment, our hearts pounding in our chests. Finally, Alex spoke, his voice trembling. "We have to go," he said. "Now." We didn't need any further urging. We turned and fled, our legs carrying us as fast as they could through the darkness. We didn't stop running until we reached the jeep, our lungs burning, our bodies soaked in sweat. We didn't look back. We didn't dare. We just drove, the headlights cutting through the darkness, the engine roaring like a caged beast. We didn't stop until we were miles away from the Superstition Mountains, the terrifying memory of that night forever etched in our minds. We never spoke of what we saw that night. We never went back to the superstitions. We knew that some secrets are best left buried, some places best left undisturbed. And we knew that the lost Dutchman's gold mine was not just a legend, but a gateway to a terrifying reality, a reality we were lucky to escape. My friend Laura and I have always loved exploring the wilderness near our homes each summer. We'd spend hours venturing into the Montana forests, uncovering hidden clearings, abandoned structures, and other forgotten remnants of the past. We found everything from decaying decontamination buildings to rusted out vehicles to a clearing strewn with women's clothing. The Montana wilderness held endless secrets, and we were determined to uncover them all. One day, we found ourselves 3 miles deep in the woods near Laura's house, searching for a supposed cult site that one of our friends, Jace, had told us about. Jace, a notorious exaggerator, had described a bizarre white face painted on a tree stump wedged between two other trees, surrounded by a massive bonfire pit. "Just something to pass the time," Laura had said, sensing my lingering unease from the encounter with the dead man at work the week before. I wasn't sure how effective a weird tree stump would be as a distraction, but I appreciated the effort. "It's the thought that counts," as my ma always says. As we ventured deeper into the woods, I couldn't shake the feeling that we were being followed. Loud footsteps echoed behind us, branches snapped, and I thought I heard the murmur of voices. Or maybe it was just animals. There were creatures in these woods that could mimic human sounds, a fact both Laura and I were well aware of. We were mostly silent, Laura preoccupied with deciphering the directions Jace had scribbled on her hand, while I scanned our surroundings, my nerves on edge thanks to the unsettling sounds that seemed to be closing in on us. Suddenly, Laura tripped over a fallen log, nearly plunging face first into the dirt. I rushed to her aid, pulling her back to her feet. "Are you all right?" I asked. She glared at me, annoyance flashing in her eyes. "Yeah, I'm fine," she muttered, her gaze fixed on something in the dirt. Not her bleeding hand, not me, not even the unsettling sounds behind us. Her eyes were locked on a white shard protruding from the mud. I knelt down and carefully extracted the shard from the earth. It was a bone fragment, a piece of a vertebra. Laura wiped the dirt and blood from her hands on her jeans before reaching for the bone. I handed it to her gingerly. "What the hell?" she exclaimed, rolling her eyes. Of all the things to cut my hand on, it had to be a freaking bone? This is ridiculous. She flung the bone aside in disgust, sending it flying into a huckleberry bush. "Better disinfect that when we get back," I said, stifling a laugh. Laura was a walking disaster. Leave it to her to find a way to injure herself on a bone while searching for a cult site. "Thanks, Doc," she grumbled, shoving past me and continuing down the trail. I trailed behind her, chuckling at her indignation. Laura's clumsiness had momentarily dispelled my paranoia. We had a knack for finding humor in the most unexpected situations, especially when it came to each other's misfortunes. We soon arrived at the spot Jace had described. The crudely painted face on the stump confirmed that this was the place. The empty beer cans and fire pits suggested it was more of a party spot than a cult gathering, but Jace was always prone to exaggeration. Laura slumped onto a boulder beside the fire pit, cradling her injured hand. "Well, this was a bust," she grumbled, scanning the trees with a bored expression. Typical. She was the one who had insisted on this little expedition, and now she was already bored. I hummed in agreement, my gaze sweeping the perimeter. A rustle in the undergrowth sent a jolt of fear through me. My paranoia returned with a vengeance. I could have sworn I saw figures lurking in the shadows, their forms shrouded in dark cloaks. Was I imagining things? Suddenly, I stumbled, my foot plunging into a shallow depression. I fell to my knees, the impact jarring my bones. "Jesus!" I gasped, scrambling back, my eyes widening in horror. Laura rushed to my side, her own face etched with alarm. "Oh my God," she breathed. I stared at the white rocks scattered across the bottom of the pit. They weren't rocks. They were bones. Human bones. Vertebrae, femurs, jawbones, ribs, a jumbled mass of skeletal remains. Laura reacted instantly, grabbing my hood and hauling me out of the pit. We didn't need to discuss what to do next. We fled, the image of that gruesome pit seared into our minds. The walk back was eerily silent. The woods, usually alive with the sounds of birdsong and rustling leaves, were deathly quiet. Even the distant rush of the river seemed muted, as if the forest itself was holding its breath. We never spoke of the bones again, not to each other, not to anyone. The shadowy figures, the bone-filled pit, the oppressive silence of the woods, it was a shared secret, a chilling experience we both silently agreed to bury deep within our memories. But the fear lingered. Driving home that night, I could have sworn I saw those cloaked figures flitting through the trees, their eyes fixed on me, a silent warning not to reveal what we had witnessed. Even in the supposed safety of my own home, I couldn't shake the feeling of being watched. I saw one of them lurking at the edge of the tree limb, its form shifting in the shadows. Fear paralyzed me. All I could do was watch. Then came the knock. Three sharp raps on my front door. I didn't move. I couldn't. The knocking was followed by scratching, long, deliberate strokes that seemed to claw at the very wood of the door. It was a chilling sound, a deliberate attempt to instill terror. I stood frozen in my kitchen, my eyes fixed on the window, my breath caught in my throat. The scratching continued, an eternity of agonizing suspense. Finally, it stopped. The figure retreated into the shadows, melting back into the tree limb. The next morning, I found deep, indecipherable scratches etched into the mahogany of my front door. A chilling reminder of the night before, a silent threat that sent shivers down my spine. I couldn't shake the feeling that I was next. Next for what? I didn't know, and I didn't want to find out. 2 weeks had passed since those things started watching me. Their presence was constant, their eyes always on me, their ears always listening. Bones started appearing on my property, a vertebra on the porch, a rib cage in the garden, a skull on the hood of my car. They were everywhere I went, a constant, macabre reminder of the pit in the woods. Luke thought I was spending too much time indoors, becoming a recluse. But I couldn't bring myself to leave the yard, not since those things started watching me. I couldn't tell him why. I didn't want to burden him with my fears. Didn't want him to become their next target. He didn't deserve to live with the same terror that consumed me. July arrived, but the events of June remained vivid, a heavy weight on my mind. Even now, as I write this, the memories haunt me. I suspect they will follow me to my grave. That night, Luke insisted on taking me for a drive. It was something we used to do a lot when we first started dating, cruising down dark back roads at 60 miles an hour, sharing stories and dreams under the cover of night. Now, as we drove in silence, I couldn't help but wonder if those things had been watching us back then, silent observers in the darkness. 30 minutes crawled by, the silence in the truck thick with unspoken tension. "Just tell me what's wrong, Jessa," Luke pleaded, his gaze fixed on the road ahead. I kept my eyes glued to the trees lining the roadside, searching for any sign of movement. They weren't there. Not yet. "Nothing's wrong," I lied, a sigh escaping my lips. I couldn't tell him. I didn't know how. "Ever since that day in the woods with Laura, you haven't been the same. It's like a part of you is still out there. Even Laura is acting strange." He turned to face me, his eyes filled with concern. "I'm right here, aren't I?" I retorted, meeting his gaze defiantly. It was a weak defense, and we both knew it. He was right. Something had changed in me that day in the woods. "Not mentally," he murmured, his voice heavy with worry. I longed to confide in him, to tell him about the shadowy figures, the bone-filled pit, the man at work whose death defied explanation. But the words wouldn't come. And then I saw them. Dozens of shadowy figures, cloaked and silent, lined the tree limb, their eyes burning into me. Panic seized me. I fumble for my phone, desperate to capture proof of their existence, proof that I wasn't losing my mind. "What are you doing?" Luke asked, his eyes darting from the road to my phone. "You don't see them?" I snapped the picture, my hand shaking. "See who?" he asked, his voice laced with concern. He thought I was hallucinating. I glanced back at the trees, but they were gone. Vanished. "Are you doing drugs?" Luke demanded, his voice sharp with accusation. The question stung. He knew how I felt about drugs, how they had ravaged my family, stolen loved ones from me. The thought that he would suspect me, it was unbearable. Anger flared in my chest, but before I could unleash it, a figure darted out from the trees, directly into our path. Luke swerved violently, the tires screaming as the truck veered off the road. My scream was swallowed by the roar of the engine and the sickening crunch of metal against bark. Then darkness. I woke up in a hospital bed, my body aching, my mind reeling. They told me I was lucky to be alive, that the crash could have been much worse. Lucky. The word felt like a cruel mockery. Luke was dead, killed by a creature they dismissed as a deer. I couldn't cry. The shock had numbed me, leaving me hollow and empty. I remember staring at the photo for hours after being released from the hospital. My phone screen had cracked because of the crash, but even then, I could tell that there was no one in the picture. Just an empty dirt road illuminated only by headlights at 1 a.m. on July 5th. They weren't there. Maybe Luke had been correct in his final moments, that there was nothing there and I was starting to go crazy. But deep down, I didn't believe it. He swerved for a reason. They killed him for a reason. Three weeks ago, my friend Michael asked me if I wanted to go camping. I'd spent the whole summer working a mind-numbing office job, so I jumped at the chance to escape the monotony. But as the weekend approached, Michael kept adding people to the group. Soon, it was six of us crammed into the SUV I inherited from my mom. I considered backing out. I'm not a fan of crowds, and Eddie, with his booming voice and questionable sense of humor, was among the additions, but I knew they needed my car to transport everyone. So, I sucked it up, figuring a little discomfort was a small price to pay for a weekend with friends. The two-hour drive was almost unbearable. Eddie ignored my no-smoking rule, filling the car with a haze of stale cigarette smoke, and his relentless, often offensive jokes made me fantasize about veering into oncoming traffic. If it weren't for Sophia, my old friend from high school, distracting him with lively conversation, I might have actually snapped. Sophia and I had drifted apart after graduation, but we reconnected instantly that day, our easy banter easing the tension in the car. It was a welcome distraction from the growing dread I felt about the camping trip. We finally arrived at the trailhead, a deserted parking lot near the edge of the forest in the Appalachian Mountains. Michael had promised a secluded campsite by a lake, but it was a two-hour hike in. I groaned inwardly. We'd left after lunch, and now, with our group's tendency to dawdle, we wouldn't reach the site until well after dark. Sure enough, it took us a good 10 minutes just to gather our gear and hit the trail. Jessica realized she'd left something in the car 5 minutes in, adding another frustrating delay. I bit my tongue, reminding myself that a little chaos was good for the soul. We trudged through the woods, the sun sinking lower in the sky. Everyone paired off, and I found myself walking alongside Sophia, catching up on each other's lives. Compared to her exciting summer adventures, my work-filled days sounded incredibly dull. An hour in, we encountered another hiker, the first sign of life we'd seen besides the occasional squirrel or bird. He was a strange guy, dressed in a baggy gray sweater despite the summer heat, his thin frame burdened by an enormous backpack. Michael and Eddie, leading the pack, stopped to chat with the stranger. "Camping?" the man asked with a friendly smile, his voice tinged with a southern drawl. Michael nodded, gesturing down the trail. "Heading to the Big Bear Tree," he said, naming a landmark near the end of the trail, a massive tree with a crudely carved bear face. "Good spot," the man replied, "but folks say it's bad luck. I'm just foraging for mushrooms." He held up a mesh bag filled with various fungi. "Heading to the ranger station on my way out. You all checked in yet? Do we need to?" I asked, surprised. The others shot me annoyed glances. I guess they were hoping to avoid any fees. "Park runs on donations," the man explained. "Even if you can't afford one, it's good to let the rangers know you're here, just in case." "You got a GPS?" "Yeah, we're good," Michael said dismissively. "Not our first rodeo." The man chuckled, seemingly unfazed by Michael's rudeness. "Got whistles?" he asked, gesturing to a collection of brightly colored plastic whistles hanging from his pack. We all shook our heads, except for Michael, who pulled out a whistle with a smug grin. The man gracefully lowered his pack and began handing out whistles, explaining that he bought them in bulk and liked to share them with fellow hikers. As he bent over, his sweater revealed a glimpse of his surprisingly muscular chest, causing Sophia and Jessica to exchange excited glances. He winked at the girls, acknowledging their interest, and they giggled, pretending to swoon. I attached the whistle to my belt loop, ignoring the group's teasing suggestions that the wink had been intended for me. We finally reached our campsite as dusk settled over the forest. Everyone scrambled to set up tents, and I fumbled with the unfamiliar poles and stakes, grateful for Sophia's assistance. Michael, who had disappeared earlier, returned with a bag of foraged mushrooms, chicken of the woods, he called them. He cooked them over the fire, and they were surprisingly delicious. After dinner, the mood shifted. Eddie produced a joint, and soon, everyone except me was passing it around. Then came the booze. I declined a beer, and Michael scowled. "Dude, you're not driving," he said, shoving the bottle towards me. "Loosen up a little." I reluctantly took the beer but passed it to Sophia. "What, are you too good for my cheap beer?" Michael sneered, his voice laced with hostility. "No, man, I just don't really drink," I said, trying to defuse the situation. "Come on, live a little," Sophia urged, offering me the bottle again. I was baffled by their insistence. I'd never enjoyed the taste of alcohol, and weed just made me paranoid. I didn't understand why my refusal was such a big deal. "I'm good," I said, holding up my hands defensively. Sophia leaned closer, her voice a harsh whisper. I think you need to grow up. Her words stung. I felt a wave of anger and confusion wash over me. I didn't understand why they were being so hostile. Was it because I had a steady job and career aspirations? Did they think I was judging them? I excused myself and retreated to my tent, my mind racing. The cheerful camaraderie of the day had evaporated, replaced by a tense awkwardness. I felt like an outsider, an unwelcome guest at their party. I lay awake, listening to their laughter and chatter around the campfire, feeling a growing sense of isolation. I decided I would just endure the rest of the weekend and then cut ties with this group. They clearly didn't want me there. Exhaustion eventually won out, and I drifted off to sleep, unaware of the horrors that awaited us. I woke to a cacophony of sounds, screams, shouts, and something that sounded like an animal in distress. I stumbled out of my tent, disoriented and confused. Ben was writhing on the ground near the fire pit, clutching his head and moaning in pain. He retched violently, his body convulsing. What's going on? Jessica cried, her flashlight beam illuminating the scene. Gross, she whispered, recoiling from the vomit. I knelt beside Ben, unsure how to help. Don't touch him, Michael snapped. Is everyone else okay? I asked, my voice tight with worry. Are you saying I poisoned us? Michael snarled, stepping towards me menacingly. No, I... Suddenly, a chilling sound cut through the night. Eddie was laughing, but it wasn't a normal laugh. It was a high-pitched, unnatural cackle that sent shivers down my spine. We all froze, our eyes wide with fear. It's too loud, Ben whimpered, clutching his head. Shut up. Shut up. Shut up. He sprang to his feet and grabbed a burning log from the fire pit, his bare hands impervious to the heat. I tackled him before he could reach Eddie, forcing him to drop the smoldering wood. I said, shut up. Ben screamed, his voice distorted and inhuman. Then it happened. A shape emerged from the darkness, charging towards us with a guttural roar. It slammed into Eddie, silencing his laughter, and sent him flying into a tree. The girl screamed, and I stumbled back, my heart pounding. In the moonlight, I saw it clearly, a massive buck, its eyes glowing with an unnatural intensity. Michael, in a panic, threw a bottle at the deer. The creature roared and charged through the campsite, tearing down tents and scattering our belongings. It was a chaotic blur of hooves and antlers, a terrifying dance of destruction. Ben, miraculously unharmed, sat down, hugging his knees, a disturbingly calm expression on his face. I stood there, shaking, trying to comprehend what had just happened. We needed to get out of there. I reached for my phone, but there was no signal. Does anyone have a working phone? I asked, my voice trembling. The girls huddled together, too terrified to speak. Michael was staring at Eddie's crumpled form, his face pale and drawn. Do you have a satellite phone? I asked Michael, desperate for any means of communication. Not all of us are loaded like you, he snapped, his voice filled with resentment. I was taken aback by his hostility. That's not the point. I retorted, we need to get help. My mind raced. We needed to reach the ranger station. They would have a radio. I'm going to head back to the SUV, I announced. Michael, you know these woods better than anyone. You should go to the ranger station and get help. Anyone who wants to come with me to the car is welcome too. To my surprise, Jessica and Sophia opted to stay at the campsite with Eddie and Ben. I glanced nervously at Ben, who was still sitting silently, his gaze fixed on some unseen point in the distance. I couldn't shake the feeling that something was terribly wrong. I set off down the trail, the darkness pressing in around me. I had only gone a short distance when I heard screams echoing from the campsite. I turned back, my heart pounding, but a deer darted out from the trees, blocking my path. More screams pierced the night, and I watched helplessly as the deer turned its head towards me, its eyes glowing with an unnatural light. It mirrored my every move, its eerie behavior sending chills down my spine. The deer let out a haunting cry, and I turned and fled, the sounds of the forest growing louder and more distorted with every step. I stumbled through the darkness, my flashlight beam dancing across the uneven terrain. Suddenly, the ground disappeared beneath my feet, and I tumbled down a steep embankment, my body slamming against rocks and tree roots. I landed with a sickening thud, the wind knocked out of me. Through the ringing in my ears, I heard a voice calling down from above. Are you all right? I looked up and saw the silhouette of the stranger we had met earlier on the trail. He was without his backpack, and his sweater was a darker shade now. Hang on, I'll get you, he said, and before I could protest, he was gracefully descending the steep slope. He knelt beside me, examining my injuries. Did you hit your head? Can you move? Yeah, I think so, I mumbled, slowly sitting up. We need to get back to my friends. They're in trouble. Strange things are happening. He helped me to my feet, and to my embarrassment, offered to carry me on his back. I'm not a koala, I protested weakly. It's faster this way, he insisted. I reluctantly agreed, and he effortlessly carried me up the embankment. So, Mr. Koala, he said with a chuckle, what's your name? I'm Arlen. Michael, I muttered, still reeling from the events of the night. Well, Michael, Arlen said, at least you weren't attacked by a rabid squirrel. That's what happened to me. Had to ditch my pack to outrun the little beast. I managed a weak laugh. Arlen's easygoing nature was a welcome contrast to the terror that had gripped me just moments before. What kind of people are your friends? He asked as we made our way back towards the campsite. I hesitated, unsure how to answer. Ben was a rock, I finally said. Always calm and supportive. But around Eddie, he could be pretty goofy. And Eddie? I grimaced, the image of Eddie's twisted form flashing through my mind. Eddie wasn't the sharpest tool in the shed. Kind of annoying, to be honest. But he had a good heart. He was always kind and generous. I stopped walking, my body suddenly heavy with grief and exhaustion. I'm sorry, I whispered, tears swelling up in my eyes. I just... Arlen gave me a reassuring nod. Take your time, he said gently. I was amazed by his composure. He had just witnessed the same horrors I had, yet he remained calm and collected. I, on the other hand, was a mess. We continued on, the silence broken only by the occasional snap of a twig or the distant hoot of an owl. As we approached the campsite, the smell of blood grew stronger and my heart sank. The clearing was a scene of carnage. Blood stained the ground, and the fire pit had been overturned, embers scattered across the clearing. Arlen stamped out a few smoldering patches, then noticed something glinting in the moonlight. It was Eddie's lighter. Was I wrong? I whispered, more to myself than to Arlen. What do you mean? He asked gently. I hesitated, unsure whether to confide in him. But something about his calm demeanor made me trust him. My friend got hurt, I explained. I left to get help, but no one would come with me. Should I have forced them? What happened after I left? What is going on? You couldn't have forced them, Arlen said reassuringly. And I don't have any answers for you. But it is strange that you didn't have any cell service. Was it spotty all day? I realized that our phones had been working fine before dinner. A wave of guilt washed over me. I should have checked my phone again. Maybe I could have gotten a signal. I pulled out my phone. Its screen cracked from my fall. For a fleeting moment, a single bar of signal flickered on my screen, then vanished just as quickly. I held my phone aloft, as if that would somehow improve the reception, but it was futile. Arlen, sensing my desperation, took my phone and held it even higher, but to no avail. We were cut off from the outside world. Michael went to the ranger station, I said, my voice tight with worry. Maybe we should go there too. I can lead the way, Arlen offered. Really? I asked, surprised by his willingness to help. Sure, why not? He said with a shrug. You don't even know us, I pointed out. I know you, he said with a playful grin. You're a koala in disguise. I couldn't help but smile. Despite the horrifying circumstances, Arlen's lightheartedness was a welcome distraction. We left the campsite, the gruesome scene illuminated by the flickering flames of the burning tree. I picked up the axe Michael had been using to chop firewood, its weight comforting in my hand. We walked in silence for a while, the darkness pressing in around us. My mind raced, trying to make sense of the night's events. What had caused the animals to become so aggressive? Why had Ben and Eddie gotten sick? And what were those things that had emerged from their bodies? Arlen suddenly stopped, his gaze fixed on something in the distance. I followed his gaze, but I couldn't see anything. Then, a whistle pierced the silence. I fumbled for the whistle the stranger had given me earlier and blew into it, the shrill sound echoing through the trees. A moment later, the whistle sounded again, closer this time, followed by a faint cry for help. Ben! I shouted, my voice hoarse with relief. We hurried towards the sound, our hearts pounding with a mix of hope and fear. We found Ben huddled beneath a tree, his face streaked with tears. It's so dark, he whimpered. I got scared. We're going to the ranger station, I said, trying to reassure him. It's not far now. No, Ben said, his voice taking on a strange, childlike quality. It's too scary. I want to go to bed. But I need Mr. Hoppy to sleep. Mr. Hoppy? I asked, confused. He's my. Ben struggled to find the words. He helps me sleep. He reached out and grabbed my wrist, his grip surprisingly strong. Come with me, he whispered. We can all sleep together. His face contorted into a grotesque grin, his mouth stretching impossibly wide. I recoiled in horror, but it was too late. His grip tightened, and I felt a sharp pain in my arm. Arlen reacted instantly. He swung the axe, severing Ben's arm at the elbow. I cried out in shock, but Arlen pulled me away, dragging me through the undergrowth. We didn't stop running until we reached a clearing. I collapsed against a tree, my breath coming in ragged gasps. Ben's severed hand was still clutched around my wrist, its grip surprisingly strong even in death. Arlen pried the hand away and tossed it into the bushes. He looked at me, his face etched with concern. Are you all right? He asked. I nodded, unable to speak. I was still reeling from the encounter with Ben. The image of his distorted face burned into my mind. We're almost there, Arlen said, his voice soothing. Just a little further. We continued on, the silence broken only by the sound of our footsteps and the occasional rustle of leaves. As we approached the ranger station, a sense of dread washed over me. The windows were dark, and an unnatural stillness hung in the air. Arlen cautiously approached the cabin, his hand resting on the axe handle. He pushed the door open, and we stepped inside. The sight that greeted us was horrifying. The ranger's body lay sprawled on the floor, his head severed from his body. Blood splattered the walls and furniture, painting a gruesome picture of violence. I gasped, covering my mouth to stifle a scream. Arlen quickly scanned the room, his eyes searching for any sign of danger. He spotted a radio on a shelf and rushed towards it. It's broken, a voice said from behind us. We turned to see a man standing in the doorway, his face pale and drawn. He wore a white lab coat and a security badge hung from his belt. Who are you? Arlen asked, his voice wary. My name is John, the man said. I'm a researcher. I was sent here to investigate the incidents. Incidents? I asked, my voice trembling. What incidents? John hesitated, his gaze darting between Arlen and me. There's been an outbreak, he finally said. A contagion. A contagion? Arlen repeated, his eyes narrowing. What kind of contagion? John took a deep breath. We're not sure yet, he said. But it seems to be affecting the local flora and fauna. Affecting them how? I asked, my heart pounding. John's face grew even paler. It's mutating them, he said. Changing them. He described the symptoms, the aggression, the distorted features, the unnatural growths. It was all too familiar. Can it infect humans? Arlen asked, his voice dangerously low. John nodded grimly. Yes, he said. Through ingestion or contact. I felt a wave of nausea wash over me. We had eaten those mushrooms. There's no cure, John said, his voice heavy with despair. The only way to stop it is to destroy the infected. He pointed to the ranger's body. We need to burn it, he said. And anything else that's been infected. Arlen grabbed the axe and swung it, splitting the ranger's body in two. Then he turned to John, his eyes filled with a cold fury. Why wasn't the park closed? He demanded. John flinched. We didn't know the extent of the outbreak, he said. We thought it was contained to a different area. I was sent here to investigate. And your colleague? Arlen asked, gesturing to the headless body on the floor. John's face flushed with shame. We got separated, he mumbled. I panicked. You left him to die, Arlen said accusingly. John hung his head. I'm sorry, he whispered. Sorry won't bring him back, Arlen said coldly. He turned to me, his expression softening. We need to get out of here, he said. Now. We left the ranger station, the gruesome scene behind us a grim reminder of the danger we were in. As we made our way through the forest, the first rays of dawn began to filter through the trees. We're almost there, Arlen said, his voice filled with hope. Just a little further. But as we reached the edge of the woods, we found our path blocked by a figure standing in the shadows. It was Michael. His clothes were stained with blood, and he held a severed deer head in his hand. Why are you here? He asked, his voice flat and emotionless. I thought you went back to the car. I got sidetracked, I said, my voice trembling. I did what I was told, Michael said, his eyes fixed on some distant point in the forest. I came here. I took care of the deer that hurt Eddie. They all told me not to. They want me to join them. But you were my friends first. Where are the girls? I asked, my voice barely a whisper. Sophia is at the big bear tree, Michael said. I can't hear Jessica anymore. Or Ben. My heart sank. They were all gone. Consumed by the contagion. They want me to take you with me, Michael said, his voice growing louder, more insistent. There are so many voices telling me what to do. His face contorted, his features twisting into a grotesque mockery of a human expression. Tendrils of flesh sprouted from his back, reaching towards us like grasping claws. Arlen reacted instantly. He charged at Michael, swinging the axe. But Michael was too quick. He dodged the blow and grabbed Arlen's wrist, twisting it until the axe clattered to the ground. I screamed, but the sound was swallowed by the dense forest. Michael lunged at Arlen, his tendrils wrapping around his throat. Arlen struggled, but he was no match for Michael's monstrous strength. I grabbed a rock and hurled it at Michael's head, but it bounced harmlessly off his thick hide. He was going to kill Arlen. Stop. I screamed, my voice raw with fear. Michael turned his head towards me, his eyes burning with an unnatural intensity. Join us, he hissed. Become one with the collective. I shook my head, tears streaming down my face. No, I whispered. I won't. Michael roared and lunged at me, his tendrils reaching out like grasping claws. I closed my eyes, bracing for the inevitable. But the blow never came. I opened my eyes to see Arlen standing between Michael and me, his face pale but determined. He held the axe in his hands, its blade glinting in the moonlight. Get back, he said, his voice low and dangerous. Michael hesitated, his eyes flickering between Arlen and me. Then, with a guttural roar, he charged. Arlen swung the axe, the blade slicing through the air. It connected with Michael's arm, severing it at the elbow. Michael howled in pain, his tendrils recoiling. Arlen pressed his attack, hacking and slashing at Michael's mutated form. The creature roared and thrashed, but it was no match for Arlen's ferocity. Finally, with a final, desperate blow, Arlen buried the axe in Michael's chest. The creature shuddered, its eyes widening in surprise, then collapsed to the ground, its life extinguished. Arlen stood over Michael's body, his chest heaving, his hands covered in blood. He looked at me, his eyes filled with a mixture of sadness and relief. It's over, he said, his voice hoarse. I nodded, unable to speak. The events of the night had left me numb, my mind struggling to process the horrors I had witnessed. We left the clearing, the gruesome scene behind us a stark reminder of the danger we had faced. As we walked, I couldn't help but wonder what had caused this outbreak, this terrifying transformation of nature. Arlen seemed to sense my thoughts. It came from the sky, he said quietly. Some kind of extraterrestrial pathogen. I looked at him, my eyes wide with disbelief. Extraterrestrial? I repeated. Arlen nodded. It's been spreading, he said. Slowly but surely. We need to find a way to stop it before it's too late. We reached the ranger station, and John emerged, his face etched with worry. He had heard the commotion and feared the worst. He was relieved to see us alive, but horrified by the news of Michael's transformation. We need to warn the others, John said, his voice urgent. We need to evacuate the park. But it was too late. As we spoke, a wave of distorted figures emerged from the trees, their eyes glowing with an eerie light, their bodies contorted into monster shapes. The creatures charged towards us, their screams echoing through the forest. We were outnumbered, outmatched. Arlen grabbed my hand and pulled me towards the ATV. We have to go, he said. Now! We jumped on the ATV and sped away, the creature's screams fading into the distance. We didn't stop until we reached the edge of the park, where we abandoned the ATV and continued on foot, our hearts pounding with fear. We didn't know where to go, where to hide. The world had become a terrifying place, a place where nature itself had turned against us. We walked for hours, the sun beating down on us mercilessly. We were exhausted, hungry, and terrified. But we couldn't stop. We couldn't rest. We had to keep moving. Finally, As the sun began to set, we stumbled upon a small town. We collapsed on a park bench, our bodies aching, our minds reeling. We were safe. For now. But we knew that the creatures were still out there, lurking in the shadows, waiting for their next victims. And we knew that we would never be the same.